Morning, everyone. Hi.
Welcome.
So exciting. Welcome, everyone. It is so nice to see so many familiar faces. Natasha is going to make a quick announcement for me.
Good morning. To access Spanish translation at the bottom of your screen, please select the interpretation globe and click Spanish. Para acceder a la traducción al español, en la parte inferior de su pantalla, seleccione el globo terráqueo de interpretación y haga clic en español.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. My name is Leah Benz. I work for the Department of Health Services, and I'm so excited you are all here. As many of you remember, we launched our racial equity effort in February of 2020, right before we faced civil unrest, death of people of color, riots, and a pandemic. So this training came at a very unique time. And although we have far to go, our community did a lot in the last year, so much work. And I bet each of you here today can recall an event or a Zoom gathering or a training or an uncomfortable conversation that you had that led to some change for you or those around you. and change can be too slow. And I am embarrassed to say that this is the first time we have had Spanish translation at a Health Action Council meeting. It's a long time coming, and I want to welcome Spanish speakers to this event today. We're so glad you're here. This is long overdue and a small step. I'm certain that as we grow, we will make mistakes. So we look to all of you to provide feedback to staff and let us know how we can do better. But today we have incredibly talented trainers, Dr. Curtis Acosta and Carlos Hagedorn, leading us through a day of learning. Many of you already know and love Curtis and Carlos, that they've worked with Santa Rosa City Schools, Health Action Chapters, Redwood Community Health Coalition, probably 10 other groups in the county. Their work in Healdsburg alone laid a huge foundation for transformational change. Corazon tapped them to work with their K-12 school district to adopt and implement an ethnic studies program. Ariel Kelly shared with me yesterday that their leadership, the district's leadership, liked them so much. They asked Curtis and Carlos to be keynote speakers at their back to school kickoff event. We're so grateful to get to work with them and thankful that they have embraced Sonoma County. I will now hand it over to them, but before I do, I just want to acknowledge Aaliyah Tantarelli, Backbone staff for DHS and Health Action. She, it is because of her push and her research and her passion that we are in this room today. So I'm grateful to work with her and just wanted to take one little second to say it. All right, Curtis and Carlos, take it away. Thank you.
Beautiful, thank you so much. Welcome everyone, buenos dias, cualita Nelsi, good morning. I am Carlos Hagedorn. I'm gonna briefly introduce myself. Curtis, I promise it's gonna be short, and then I'll pass it to you to introduce yourself. But thank you so much, Leah, for setting the context, setting the foundation. I know that we saw many of you last February. Was it last February already? It was last February in person. Again, my name is Carlos Hagedorn, I'm a Chicano Filipino. I identify as he, him, él, his, educator at heart. I teach ethnic studies at the college level as well as the K-12. And it's an honor to be here with my compañero, with my brother, Curtis Acosta, as we provide our a support and some palabra with you all today around thinking about what is eradicating racial inequity look like for Sonoma County, right? We've been in this conversation for some time now, and we're here to support you to think about new ways, innovative ways, new models perhaps, or also affirm what you're already doing, being on the ground as such. So it is an honor to be here. In a moment, I'll let you know where I am zooming in from as we do a land acknowledgement. But for now, I'd like to pass it to my brother, Curtis.
Gracias, trazo camarmi to my brother Carlos and to Leah for that really humbling introduction. It's always an honor to be with you all in Sonoma County. We're really, really honored by the amount of time and the relationships we've been able to build during a really difficult time to do so. So I want to honor all the time and all the friendly faces I see out there and my friends that Carlos and I have made through the last year, but also the new friends and the new relationships that we're going to build today as well. And we are deeply connected to schools. Carlos and I are educators at heart. So this is education too, even though we're looking at it through a more community lens, a more global lens, a more health oriented lens, and all the different avenues that play into one being healthy, a community being healthy, an individual being healthy. So we're really honored about that and to be a part of that. Like Carlos said, we see ourselves as facilitators, as folks that cultivate space for you to do the real work since you know your community. I mean, we're honored to like always be with you in community, but you're the experts in your communities. And so today we're going to actually look at the community and cultural wealth of your community, right? We're going to look at through an asset lens. So Aaliyah did name many challenges we had in 2020 and beyond. They were there before 2020. You know, Carlos and I actually, after our work together with you all in February, and then the pandemic really hitting our country, we started thinking about what were the viruses present before COVID, because we had many and we still do. And so that was part of our work last time. And we'll do a little review for those of you that didn't have an opportunity to be with us in February of 2020. We're gonna be able to set some context and then we'll move forward. Live simply, I'm Curtis Acosta. I'm a biracial Chicano. I don't have a really cool like Chicapino or like my brother Carlos, he has a really way he gets smash it up. So I used to call myself caramel vanilla swirl, you know, like a yogurt machine or like a, you know, soft serve. So I share European American heritage from my mother's side and Mexican heritage from my father's side. I'm proud of both. I've been using the Chicano Viking as a way of like announcing my heritage and my family's history to different spaces. As Carlos said, we're very, very honored to be here and proud educators and proud to be doing the work with your amazing youth and teachers and educational leaders in Sonoma County. So back to Carlos, because I know we have more to do today, so I don't want to take too much time.
Gracias, Emmanuel. So y'all, we're going to share a screen now, and we want to first start off with land acknowledgement and vision. Then Curtis will walk us through our philosophy of In La Quech. And then we're going to come back and get into the agenda and do a little bit more of some Zoom logistics before we dive deep into a little bit of some music mixtape action. Yes, we'll all be dancing at some point today, soon. And then we'll continue on. So give me a moment to catch up with my Zoom consciousness here. Let me see. Okay, here we go. All right. And Curtis, can I get a thumbs up that you can see? Cool. So again, y'all, welcome to this wonderful morning to be in community with you all. We are giving this 4-hour community building space. We're centering in La Quech. We're centering community and cultural wealth, as Curtis was just sharing, by centering Sonoma County with the goal to eradicate racial inequity. And this is no light lift. In fact, we are engaging in a 500-year battle when it comes to eradicating racial inequity and all inequities when we think about intersectional identities. We want to make sure that we're acknowledging the land and the people, as well as providing a vision of what land acknowledgement means for us. And so I'm going to first ask Curtis and myself to share our land acknowledgement, but also we're going to share the Sonoma County land acknowledgement after this. But in the meantime, if you'd like, in the chat box, please acknowledge the indigenous peoples on whose lands you live, right? We do land acknowledgement, right, first and foremost, to continue to honor truth, to continue to honor the 7 generations before, the 7 generations after, and currently the people who whose lands that we're on. In addition, as I think Curtis will share in a little bit when we say in La Quech, we honor indigenous land as a way for us to reflect upon our practices in all relations. What does it mean to be in all relations with land, with people, with our four-legged relatives, with our Mother Earth, and by honoring the people who have come before us? I come to you today from uninvited. I'm an uninvited guest on unceded territory, the Patwin and Wapo and Pomo people. And today it's called the Napa Valley, and that's where I am today, but I want to honor whose lands that I am blessed to be on today. Curtis?
Yes, and I come to you all today as an uninvited guest on Tohono O'odham land and the Pascua-Yaqui Nation as well. Two really thriving parts of our community here in what's popularly known as Tucson, Arizona. And it's, you know, a lot. I remember growing up, I'm a Bay Area kid. I grew up in the South Bay, and we didn't really have a connection to whose land we were on and the original stewards, let alone the idea of, you know, those folks still being thriving with us. It wasn't until I got to Tucson that I was really lucky enough to be in a community that still has, a vibrant connection to the indigenous, the original stewards of the land and the original peoples. Tucson itself, the name comes from an Odom word meaning the Chukchon, which means black base. And if you've ever been down to Tucson, the original spot where civilization bloomed, and there's a mountain with a dark base on the bottom, and that's where the word comes from. So I'm so happy and thrilled that we have this last of 10 years or so started acknowledging the histories of where we really are and the complications of what it means to be an American when we know that this land is originally someone else's, and what that means for all of us, whether we're immigrants, native ourselves native to the land we're on, or native ourselves in this continent of Turtle Island. And also for those of us that didn't have that were brought here forcefully. So it shows the amazing promise of all of our stories as Americans, but it's a complicated process. It's complex and one that needs to be given time and given space and given love for us to all to reflect upon.
Thank you, hermano. You know, as Curtis was sharing his palabra, I was reflecting upon, you know, when we talk about 500 years of colonization, right, you know, and when we're centering Sonoma County, in which I'm a neighbor of, you know, thinking about, you know, the last California mission made it to Sonoma County, and it still resides there as a historical landmark, right? So when we think about land acknowledgement, we have to confront things such as that, right? That is a concrete thing that we have to confront. And how do we retell that story in a more truthful, decolonizing, in you know, centering our indigenous peoples and indigenous epistemologies and in understanding that not just historical context, but it currently still resides there, right? So I'm just thinking about that as well as we reflect upon that. Also want to just restate that Curtis and I are educators at heart, we're teachers at heart, and centering voice is really, really a value of ours. And so we're going to ask for people to volunteer to, you know, read certain slides that we're going to bring up, or to share your wisdom with us. I'm really appreciative of those who are sharing in the chat box your land acknowledgement. Thank you so much. We do, and we would love someone to volunteer to read Sonoma County's land acknowledgement. And if I'm getting this wrong, Leah or Leah, please set some context. But I would love someone, meaning where did this come from? I guess that's what I should have said if I'm getting this wrong. But we would love someone to volunteer to read the County of Sonoma land acknowledgement. And you can simply unmute yourself and just dive deep into this. Thank you.
If it would be appropriate for a county supervisor to do this, I'll volunteer.
Chris, thank you so much.
The County of Sonoma recognizes that we are on the ancestral lands of the Coast Miwok, Pomo, and Wapo, who are the original caretakers of this area. We respectfully acknowledge the indigenous peoples who have been stewarding and maintaining relationship on this land as knowledge keepers for millennia. The County of Sonoma is dedicated to understanding and educating the public about historical and ongoing connections between land conservation and social inequities. This includes the histories of genocide, forced removal and displacement, and broken promises with indigenous peoples as part of American history. Indigenous people are not just in our histories. We strive to optimize indigenous voices to share their own history, as to not perpetuate another form of being silenced. While recognizing the past, we honor the resiliency of Native people still in their ancestral territories. And a chat box just popped up in front of the last line here. I'm sorry, yeah. I'm going to start that sentence again. While recognizing the past, we honor the resiliency of Native people still in their ancestral territories in relationship with their land and culture.
Thank you so much, Chris, for that wonderful read. And thank you everyone for being present and for sharing where you are zooming in from and for taking a moment to reflect upon, again, seven generations before, seven generations ahead, and our own communities and where we're at. Curtis?
Gracias, Chris and Carlos, thank you. I really love that last line and throughout and what Carlos said as well, that emphasis on relationships and, you know, indigenous ways of being and knowing in our journey. Carlos and my personal journeys, we've been on this road learning from our indigenous brothers and sisters and learning about our own ties to indigeneity as Chicanos for years, but we're still very much novices in this. And I think that's a good attitude to have, is to think of yourself as a learner always. You know, part of being teachers is needing to be a good learner and a good listener. And so, but that idea of relationships is really important, because it goes, as Carlos said, it goes beyond the human relationships, which we're very much in our country striving to do better. To be honest, Carlos, you know, he brought up the idea of truth, the idea of something that's, you know, that we honor the honesty in our histories, the honesty in how we all came to this space and place in the United States and California at this point in the human journey. And so one of the things that really guides Carlos and I, when we think about, you know, ourselves and you know, and the fact that we have a consulting company and the work that we do with the children and for the children of your county and other places throughout the country and with the educators is principles, right? Principles that align very much with indigeneity, with the ideas that come from our ancestry. And one of that is from our Mayan brother, our Mayan ancestors, and that's the concept of Inakesh. And so what you see here is five lines from a poem, a larger poem by the Chicano playwright and wonderful American scholar and artist, Luis Valdez, who founded El Teatro Campesino and was very much a child of the United Farm Workers movement, a movement that of a labor movement, a civil rights movement, a human rights movement that still inspires, you know, Carlos and I to this very day, and who we try to honor in any and all the work we do. And so what Luis was able to do and share with us through his art is his in person his interpretation of what Inakesh, this Mayan concept, meant to him. And so as close as we can translate in Spanish and English, Inakesh, that the Mayan phrase translates to tú eres mi otro yo, or you are my other me. And so for the purposes of time today, I'm gonna read this to you all. Normally when we're working with youth or we're working in the virtual space, we ask folks to read a line. You know, when we're working with teachers or youth, it doesn't matter whom we're working with, to read a line and to give multiple voices. When we were in person in February 2020, when one of the last times Carlos and I were being able to facilitate it with people in live, we did it all together. We did it chorally, and we look forward to that day again, because there's a beautiful type of healing that can happen, an inspiration that happens when all these words are said aloud together. But I ask you for just, you know, because of the purposes of like getting volunteers and in the chat box, and they're all, you know, nearly 100 of us here today, which is really such an honor, and shows such great organizing by Health Action, such power in what you all are doing in Sonoma County. I'm gonna read it to you all as a commitment from Carlos and I to your community, and also hopefully some inspiration from our ancestors, whether they be a little bit closer to our time period, like Luis Valdez, who's very much still an artist with us, or the original ancestors who are still with us, the Mayans, that carry this knowledge and this way of being as a principle to guide us, not only today, but for the actions that we do from today that are inspired from our connections and community building that we do today. So here we go. En la Quech, tú eres mi otro yo, you are my other me. Si te hago daño a ti, if I do harm to you, me hago daño a mí mismo, I do harm to myself. Si te amo y respeto, if I love and respect you, me amo y respeto yo, I love and respect myself.
That's the Kamati, brother. Thank you so much, y'all. So again, welcome, y'all. We are in the last part of our welcome, and that was Curtis sharing in Lakech. If you were with us in February, we really took a deep dive into in Lakech as the framework. And for those of you who we get the honor to work with, you know that is something that we continue to use as far as how to engage in humanizing practices, right? And you know, transforming dehumanizing systems, and of course, making
and get dressed. No, you didn't.
Into more humanizing spaces and systems. So, y'all, we have a dynamic next 3.5 hours, and so I say that because as long as we're going to continue to be in Zoom, I'm just going to be honest. I am still learning. There is still a lot of things I'm learning about Zoom that I don't feel 100%. Confident about. And so I'm saying that because we're going to be doing a lot of share screen. We have various links that we're going to ask you to engage with, right? And I'm asking everyone to be patient with us, and we're going to be patient with you, and we're going to do this together. If for some reason we don't get through everything through the 100 slides that Curtis and I have, we're teachers, we get it. We will let that stuff go, because this is about centering all of us today and about providing some lens work so that we understand how to use these as tools as we go back into our communities today and moving forward, right? So we are going to do, we're going to do an opening community builder. We're going to do a mixtape. We have one beautiful song that we want to get the day started with. And so rather than break out in breakout groups, we're actually going to have you all use the chat box for the mixtape, right? But you can still totally dance. You can still totally sing, you know, so, that's still on the table. From 8:30 to 9, Curtis is going to bring us back into a humanizing framework for institutional inequity, really bringing back that in Lakech framework and, what does institutional equity look like? And then at 9 o'clock, from 9 to 10, we're going to go through part one of the community cultural wealth model. This is the lens, both in Lakech and the community cultural wealth model are the two lenses that we're asking us to engage with today and moving forward. The community cultural wealth model, we will go through a variety of examples. Some will be storytelling, some will be videos, right? And that's where I'll be doing different shared screens. And we'll be asking you questions that you will be answering by using a Padlet link. And we'll share that with you when the time is best to do that, okay? At 10 o'clock, you'll have a break, 10 to 10:15, but please take a break if you need to, at any point today. And then from 10:15 to 11:15, we're gonna re-enter the community cultural wealth part two, by asking you to go into your respective communities and breakout groups, and we're going to explain that in a moment, where you're going to do some mapping of your own community using the cultural wealth model, okay? And then we'll come back at 11:15, and what does it look like to elevate our work together for real change, all right? That is our agenda. I'm going to pass it off, I think, to Leah or someone who's going to go over these very detailed instructions to support our breakout groups.
Thank you. Yes. So renaming yourself. Later in the event, we're going to be breaking out into groups, and we wanted you to pick the either the city you live or the city you do most of your work in, so that we can distribute ourselves amongst the county. And if you are a Spanish speaker, or you feel like your work is so very countywide, pick Sonoma County, and then those people will stay in the main room so that we can keep the interpretation going. But to do it, we want you to rename yourself. So if you don't know how to do that, you open the participant list, you go over to your name, and then you can rename yourself. So first, yes, so pick your city like this. So don't put anything that's not on there because we have 10 rooms. So please pick one of those. If you don't live in one of those areas and you don't work in one of those areas, you can pick Sonoma County or just choose one that makes the most sense for you. So your name, then the city you live or the city that you want to be in the group with today. And then you may also add your pronouns as well, if you would like. And the next slide is the instructions about renaming. If you could do that now so that we can start getting your breakout rooms assigned. It's not going to happen right away, but just want you to help us prepare. And if you have questions, just chat us and we'll help you. Okay. Thanks. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Just mm-hmm. give me a moment to see if there's any questions. Okay, y'all, we're going to move forward. And of course, we'll go back to that, you know, once folks might need some more clarity around that. So thank you so much. Okay, y'all, so we're going to let's get in this, y'all. If you recognize this historical artifact, then you are one with Curtis and I, because this is where we grew up. We grew up in this beautiful generation of the beautiful tape cassette. I still miss this beautiful artifact. I think I still got my, I'm gonna let you all know a little bit more about who I am. I'm a Chicano deadhead. So I still got my Grateful Deadhead tapes in my garage somewhere. So I'm gonna have to break them out and listen to a couple shows there. Y'all, we are gonna engage with us in a wonderful song that I think really situates the work that we're all doing when we talk about racial equity. All right. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna share a song. And first I'm going to honor the artist who is the artist. And then I'm going to bring up some of their lyrics, and I'm going to ask for another volunteer to actually read those lyrics out loud. Once that's done, I'll bring up a guiding question for all of us that you will all answer in the chat box. Okay. You will all answer in the chat box. While you're answering it, I'm going to actually play the song. All right, so we'll be able to listen to this. So you can stand up and dance a little bit while you're typing, right? If you wanna, close out your video so that no one sees you, that's all good, right? Just remember, dancing is really wonderful medicine for the heart and spirit, okay? So our track today, and if there's time, actually, we're gonna end today with another track, right? But our track today is from this wonderful, amazing group that I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, have seen in live in concert, because they come up north a lot. But this is from Ozo Matli, right? And the song is Guerrero, and it came out in 2001, right? Can I get a volunteer? You can go ahead and unmute yourself, a volunteer, to please read part of the lyrics of this wonderful song.
This is Dennis, I'll read.
Oh, awesome, thank you, Dennis.
I'm a revolutionary. I want to return to the front. Revolutionary, we're always struggling against something. It looks like there's no end in sight. It doesn't matter what happens. You have to continue struggling and fighting. When you see clouds in your path, when you feel you can't go on, remember that you're not alone. We always struggle together.
Beautiful read, Dennis. Thank you so much. Our question that I'd like us to answer in the chat box, right? And take some time to think about this as you're answering. What challenges are in your way with creating and sustaining a thriving community for all? Who do you need to struggle with in order to get through these challenges? That should say through these challenges. Okay. Here's the song, y'all. I'm gonna play the song, and please use the chat box to answer both these questions.
Turn this one up. Thank you.
All right, y'all. So I'm that one music person that can't stop a song in the middle of a song. I'm sorry, I'm just that person. But hopefully that gave you enough time to also share some of your reflections. Curtis is gonna read some of these before we move forward in our agenda.
Yes, and apologies to you all. This is making me think I should have done a Padlet for this activity too, because they're so strong. But I'm just gonna, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna read some that were in the beginning, scroll through some in the middle, and then some at the end. And so Matthew said, from Windsor said, one challenge is systems in place that are ingrained but aren't set up to be equitable within the community and my own organization. I need to struggle with the way we've always done it, And those who are in a position of privilege and don't see the need for change. I just think, yeah, the idea of like having to shake things up because we know it doesn't come from equitable roots is really important, the way we've always done it. Alegria from Santa Rosa said, people with privilege feel like they're going to lose something. We redirect our attention or resources with a racial or social equity lens. Brave spaces, fear of uncivil conversations, inability to depersonalize when we're talking about structural or institutional challenges. Absolutely. Noreen writes, challenges, structural racism, fear-based society, resources, scarcity, fears, struggle with myself, community, system, institutions to wake up my own current and historical injustices and share power and resources. And let me share just a couple more. Jenny wrote, Jenny from Cloverdale or Windsor or Healdsburg. That's a long handle, Jenny. But I appreciate your deep Sonoma County roots. Hard for some people to understand the reasons why, meaning that their status quo is not the same as other status quo. Some people get very offended when you share a need for us to change course or do something differently and assume you're calling them out when you are really asking them to be your partner. And I just do one more towards the end here. Brian Clement from Petaluma says, systemically, the idea of disruptive practices, a new way forward, creates pain, short-term discomfort, keeps long-term inequity in place. Awareness can bring shame. For instance, a land acknowledgement I facilitated with a national audience triggers shame for some, and they moved back and felt judged. Yeah, great. Very, very powerful stuff. Thank you, Brian, for being so honest. Thank you all for that, all that amazing insight. Carlos, any words before we keep it moving?
No, Hermano, thank you for sharing some of what people were sharing. I hope you all enjoyed that song, and that you, Spotify or iTunes or YouTube, Ozo Matli, so that you can enjoy the rest of your weekend after you're done today. Thank you. Oh, and we have another song. We'll try to play our last song at the end of today, but we have a lot to cover today.
And I really encourage everyone to read through all of them, because I just randomly went through and just selected whatever, when I scrolled, whatever popped up, kind of like a roulette style. But really look at your neighbors, look at your compañeros, words. There's really a lot of beautiful and heartfelt and really sharp analyses as well of what's going on, and we're going to need that for the rest of today. So I'm going to provide a bit of a review for us now about what we did before. Carlos, you can see the beautiful In Lakesh glyph and my slide. All right, good. So some of you can probably recognize this. This is a slide I pulled directly over from February 2020. And then some of you might have recognized it who weren't in our February meeting, but maybe some of our the chapter meetings that we were able to facilitate might recognize this as well. So I wanted to ground us. And for the new folks, don't worry, I'm gonna make sure that I explain a little bit about what the foundation that Carlos and I wanted to establish for, with you all last February, so that you could use in Lakesh this idea of tú eres mi otro yo as a lens moving forward, and what that means, like to actually operationalize it, to actually apply it in the work you all are doing in your community. So there it is. You know, I just read it to you all. And what I'd like you to do right now, just to make this a little bit more interactive, is to go ahead and just, you know, what does this mean to you? Like, throw that in the chat. For some of you that have been, you know, wrestling with this poem and this ancient wisdom that's very much lived wisdom that we can all use. And I made the joke, and I got to make it again. This is West Side knowledge, right? It's Western Hemisphere. It's our side of the globe, right? For most many of us who were born on this side, which is not the case for a lot of our institutions that are rooted in another hemisphere's knowledge that came over. But this is knowledge that comes from us. So what does Inlakesh mean to you? Or if you'd rather throw in the chat, what are some of the words in Luis's poem, his heartfelt interpretation of what Inlakesh as a way of knowing and a way of being means to him? Any of the words that stand out to you? For me, what hit me is amor, love. And so when I decided to ask my students in the fall of 2007, it was the class of 2008, as they graduated in 2008, I asked the senior class if they'd like to read this every day, these lines together, as a way of grounding ourselves in the work that we were doing. And they agreed. And so we started the practice that you and I, that we did in February of 2020, but also today, me reading to you. We started doing that daily in all of my classes, and it became, you know, a way of, for us to reorganize the way we think about school and our relationship to one another. And so so for me, it was, I wanted them to hear explicitly from their teacher that I loved them. And I wanted them to hear from their peers that they loved them. And then I wanted them to say it to the classroom space as well. But there's many more, and some of you are throwing that in the chat right now, and I really appreciate that. There are many more beautiful words here, and even more when you meditate and you reflect upon it yourself, heartfelt ways of connecting to Inlakesh. So why is Inlakesh important? So I'm actually gonna show you some different slides than I showed you last time. And that's because, I wanted to keep things a little bit fresh, but I also wanted you to, this is actually from a teaching context. So me as a classroom teacher, as a high school teacher for nearly 20 years down here in Arizona, about why having an Inlakesh pedagogy or Inlakesh like way of being in the classroom, why it was so important. And so I've been doing my own reflection and marination about this for going on decades now. And I just want to share this with you because this is, you know, we are fortunate to be working in a few of your school districts, and we provide this knowledge to the teachers about the importance of why the importance of ethnic studies beyond, you know, representation is important, but also a different way of doing school is very important, a different way of looking at our communities working together. So I'm just going to keep moving forward, and then I'll probably talk a little bit to these slides. So forgive the fact that they are just school specific, but think about these more broadly about community, what it means for community and what it means historically, especially for those of us who are, you know, people of BIPOC folks, Black, Indigenous, people of color, and for other marginalized folks that have been through disenfranchisement or marginalization, alienation, and dehumanization through some of the institutions of our country, historically, generational. So I'm gonna read this to you. This is my own ruminations, right? Inlakesh pedagogy, now that pedagogy is the how we teach, right? Embraces a democratic classroom that is grounded in equality. By centering our students' experiences and voices in our classrooms instead of a literature canon that is largely European male, American male authors, or history that is reflective of the European American experience, we are transforming our learning spaces into one that values equality through our practice of cultural humility. So I wanna go back to the last, I believe it was Brian that shared in the chat, the last one that I read aloud, the process of cultural humility and shame and that hits folks when they start thinking about land acknowledgement, shame hits, and then defensiveness pushes folks away from the table. And for me, that process is one that doesn't involve in Lakesh, right? That's divorced from in Lakesh, because you don't see that history as your other self. You see yourself still being centered. You know, Carlos was really cool about bringing up centering the fact that we like to center voices that are not often heard. As teachers, that's students. As a community, that's our most vulnerable, our most marginalized. Many times that's folks of color. Many times that's other disenfranchised folks because of their gender, their sexuality. And so what Brian was exposing and what that experience he had is a lack of in Lakesh. Even if there was some good-minded people there that are there for the right reasons, they still haven't really internalized. And there's a reason for that. And it's because of our schooling, right? We don't teach cultural humility because we've centered one group. So when we center one group, it has ramifications. And I'm going to continue to talk. So even though we're talking about like literature or history or like our curriculum in a classroom, I want you to think about how we center, you know, the European American experience many times in all other phases of our country. Think about media. Think about when you're flicking through Netflix. Think about if you're able to flip through Netflix being part of your privilege. Think about the stories you hear on mainstream media, the stories you see propagated in the news, right? And see who's at the center of that and whose perspective is at the center, even if they're talking about people of color or women or LGBTQIA folks or whomever, right? So I'm going to keep moving forward because this idea of cultural humility is really liberating for all of us. The fact that we can, like, I shared my own ancestry, and that's, you know, like being biracial. That's why I am able to wrestle with this. So if we are aware that our country is multicultural and pluralistic, and if we think about that, yes, California is the perfect case scenario for this, right? It is the future of our country. We don't have a dominant ethnic group anymore. There's not a majority, right? And so that is like actually a bellwether for the future for the rest of the country, which is why we're probably seeing some of the issues we have over the last 20 years or more. But we are pluralistic. There's many of us. There's, you know, and we are multicultural. And if we are that, yet we only teach one perspective of our country's story, then we are implicitly creating a hierarchy of who is more American. And I would extend that further to say who is more human, because if we're only centering one group of humans, then it makes it easier to dehumanize others. So we start stacking people's Americanness, stacking people's humanity in a hierarchical way, in a way where some people have more and some people are less. Some people are the center and some people are subordinate. They're less than. This impacts our students of color in a way where they resist, shut down, or assimilate. So I've been an educator for almost 25 years. And when I first started teaching, you would hear my colleagues talk about the kids that look like my little brothers and sisters, like, you know, just really, I mean, I was 22 when I started teaching and I taught high school. So they're 18, 17, they're only 4 or 5 years younger than me. And they were talking about them in a really dehumanizing way. Like they didn't care. They come from families that didn't care about education. And as a Chicano, as a person of Mexican descent, as a Latino, to me, even more global and more pan-ethnic term, I knew that's not the case. I knew how much education mattered to my family, to our cultura, in my community. So I didn't understand why they were dehumanizing our young ones. What I saw is students that were disengaged because they didn't feel that they were near the center, let alone at the center, and that they were being forced to learn about things that really didn't apply or show any value to whom they are and whom their families were, and who their ancestry is, and all the cultural, beautiful cultural wealth that comes from that. And we're gonna dive deep into that. So what you then see is students that resist, that like get in trouble, right? Because they're resisting actively, or they shut down. They like, you know, become the students in the back that don't do much, or they assimilate. That was me. I started just leaning into my mom's side only because that was the side that was valued. Like I still love my abuelita, my tías, my primas and primos, that was all good, but that was at home. right? That was in holidays, during Christmas, tamales, getting together. I love being Mexican there, but outside the house, I was being taught, leave that there. And it was a really painful and damaging part of my life. But it's not only folks of color that go through a psychological, you know, trauma, I would say, due to colonialism, due to the fact that this is ingrained in our schooling systems, and why Enriquez is so important to like get us back to being even and not stacked up. It also impacts the psychology of students of European heritage. So I was watching my friends, my other me's, right, Enriquez, who begin to see themselves as the center of the country. And it normalizes their experiences so much so that it is difficult to move them toward empathy. So it's difficult to move them out of the center without feeling a certain way. And that was being named in some of in what you all are talking about, being brave and also being people being defensive, right? So I'm gonna read it again. It normalizes their experience so much so that it is difficult to move them toward empathy or to be able to value different and evolving cultural perspectives in the United States. So when difference is heard, people can't hear it, because they've been trained and taught to see the world through this monocultural lens that stacks people on top of each other. And if we want to, what I often, Carlos and I talk about is if we do the stacking metaphor, what equity is moving from this vertical way of looking at human beings as some at the top and some at the bottom. Equity is moving us to a horizontal, to an Enriquez way of looking at each other, that we're all side by side. We're all fully human beings from the start. We should be equal from the start, but our systems are still built this way. And so there's a lot of work to do. We have to work, do internal work to even understand this stacking, to see the history, to know we have privilege, to know myself, I have a tremendous amount of privilege, right? And have to unpack that privilege and start being able to name it so I can start dismantling the privilege so we can start moving towards equality through equity, okay? And so that's where some of this dissonance comes from, is this, that's why Enriquez is so important. Because if you really see, it's expansive, Enriquez is seeing me, you are my other me. It's a little different than the golden rule, which is treat others as if they're yourself. That's still seeing the world through a lens that is mine only. But if you are already, through your identity, your intersectionality, through your culture, through all your gifts, if the person I see across from me or all these beautiful people in the Zoom are already my other me, it expands me beyond being Curtis Acosta and my little limited view of the world. That means I could be ready to learn. And that's that cultural humility space that we need to get to, where we can let things go, which seems like so important to hold on to, but they're not. To let things go so we can become bigger. We're bigger beyond ourselves. So this obviously gets into us in a certain kind of way. If we go back in our history, and we love, Carlos and I love showing this, and I'm not gonna take too much time for all of us to dismantle and analyze this famous portrait by John Gast called American Progress. But this is centering of European American and the beginning of and the construction or the furthering of the construction of the white identity in a visual form, right? There's no such thing as white. It's created, right? What I often tell people is we're all indigenous, just not many of us, usually in the spaces, education spaces, not many of us are indigenous from this continent, but we're indigenous people. So what does it mean for us to be real relatives of each other? And then if we think about being real relatives, real indigenous relatives with one another, then what does this mean? This idea that this is progress of America, when you see our four-legged relatives and our original stewards of this beautiful land running away from this supposed progress. But we know that's the history of our country, and that so much has been taken, and so much, you know, so many like literal lives have been taken. Land has been taken, spirit and soul have been taken, that now we have to start unpacking that in a very, very honest and hopefully assertive way. A brave way, so a courageous way so that we can get there faster, so that the unpacking and the shifting of equity to get to equality can be much faster than the project has been of subjugation, all right? If you look here closer to home, you'll see that we see the remnants of this stacking in the educational attainment. So these were slides that Carlos and I actually, they're dated, right? Because they were the slides from our last time with you all. But I just wanted to ground folks that weren't with us last time and what Enlakesh means. This is it when Enlakesh is not happening. When we see that some folks is, you know, at least a high school diploma drops from the 90s down to the 50s in Sonoma County, when we look at race and ethnicity. When we look at myself and Carlos, who have graduate degrees, we're part of 1.9%. And that's if you lump all Latinx people together, not just Chicano Mexicanos, right? That's all the whole pan-ethnic region of us that we would be, if we were residents of Sonoma County, we would be a part of that. And we can see for our African-American experience in Sonoma County, it is not much different. And as I keep moving forward, then let's look at our students now. Ninth graders who graduated high school in 4 years. And again, this is dated, but probably not too inaccurate from where we're at. We see that, you know, there's a gender gap in how well our students are doing, but also we see deplorable statistics when it comes to the gaps that our students are facing when it comes to educational attainment, which is what's, you know, but the passion of Carlos and I specifically and our skill set, that's why this is what keeps us up at night. You know, this is a crisis to us. This is life or death, because when you're losing 30 to 40% of our students, and just having a high school degree can be a really tough life, as most of us know. You know, that doesn't guarantee a lot, but not having one almost assuredly guarantees a life of a tremendous stress, pain, and disenfranchisement. And it's heartbreaking. And so our lives, and luckily him and I were both part of building programs. So we're very successful in flipping this completely so that our students who are, as Carlos has taught me, at promise and not at risk, were able to attain in the 90 percentile, the 100 percentiles of graduation and college enrollment. But after that, a lot of fear for Carlos and I, right? Because when we let them go, we hope those other institutions, we cross our fingers that they take care of them in the same way. So I'm gonna close up quickly by showing you, and putting some ideas that we talked about last time that fit really close to home for where we're going and where Carlos is gonna take us in the next part of today. So this is from my good friend, Dr. Lee Patel, who's a professor of education at University of Pittsburgh. And she wrote about one of my sheroes, which is Dr. Gloria Ladson Billings, who is one of the most impactful educators in this country in the last 50 years. It was Gloria Ladson Billings that came up with culturally relevant, and her and Geneva Gay revised that into culturally responsive. So this was in the 90s. They were the ones that brought, watch out, here comes a very controversial phrase, critical race theories perspective from law into education, right? To be honest, I can go off about critical race theory and how we shouldn't have to worry about all these incredibly unconstitutional laws that are being passed about it because of a lawsuit I was deeply involved with here in Arizona against our state when it attacked us for similar things. But that's a different talk at a different time. We want to talk about what's going on in Sonoma County and all the beautiful cultural community wealth you have and cultivating that. But I want us to look at this lens because it's a really important thing, because there's questions that Carlos asked us last time that I want to get to as inspiration for where we're going next. So to quote Dr. Patel, in her 2006 presidential address to the American Educational Research Association, Gloria Ladson Billings called upon educational researchers to shift their lenses from the achievement gap to the educational debt. A debt is something that is owed. A gap can simply exist. A debt raises questions of who owes whom and who stands to benefit and surfaces questions of equity. So I wanted to use that language I did earlier in the prior slide, because that's the language we've been using in education for too long. Look at these gaps. Now I want you to think about all those educational statistics in Sonoma County and all the different the health statistics we have, and think about it as a debt that is owed the people, the youth, the most vulnerable of Sonoma County. We have already paid in to this promise and this dream, but there's a debt owed. And if some of you are lovers of the civil rights movement of the 60s, the late 50s and the early 60s, you'll know that a lot of that language Dr. King used in his famous speech of I Have a Dream speech about a promissory note, right? There's a promissory note, an IOU to the African-American experience, to the Black experience, to the BIPOC experiences, to the indigenous people of this country, and many, many more. And this is the language that Dr. Ladson Billings was able to like highlight for us. So what I want us to think about, education being a piece of how we look at health index, right? But really it's a health debt we have. A debt is something owed again, a gap can simply exist, but who owes whom, and who stands to benefit? That's what I want us to be thinking about. And the last slide I want to share is questions. I'm sorry. So we can see this health debt. Carlos found this data for us in some of the work we were doing with our teachers and just to first to show the shocking differences of power and privilege in our country. COVID was rampant and it affected so many of us. Simultaneously, there was also an exponential crisis of how COVID affected different peoples. So for all Americans, we have lost as a group one whole year of life expectancy, which is just dramatic, traumatic, and just to be, you know, to use my like own like casual language, that's crazy in my mind. To lose a year of life expectancy for a country in a year is unbelievable. It's traumatic. But if you look at raza, Latinx peoples, it's almost 2 years. And if you look at our Black brothers and sisters, it's been almost 3 years of life expectancy in 1 year. That has just decimated our communities of color. And so these questions were the ones that Carlos gave us that I want us to think about with this debt mentality. We owe it. So this is time for us to start like really letting go of that privilege and using that power for others in a way that isn't philanthropic, that is with community. And that's what Carlos is gonna help us with today, a lens to absolutely see the assets and the strengths of our community. What are the debts that are owed for your families and youth in Sonoma County? What material conditions, resources need to be created, reallocated or changed so that community dignity is achieved? And so I will, after I stop sharing, which will be just in a couple seconds, I wanna let you marinate with that for just a couple more seconds. I'm gonna put those questions in the chat and I want us to keep thinking about that throughout the rest of today. They are just insightful and very, very messages, questions to the heart of why we're here today that Brother Carlos brought up last time when we were together in February. And the project that we should all be about together as we continue to try to push forward. So in Lakesh to you all, and kick it back to my brother Carlos.
Tasukamati hermano, thank you so much. You know, y'all think, you know, thinking about in Lakesh, that's a constant action, right? Like, you know, if we say you know, love is action, right? In Lakesh is action. What we want to do is take in Lakesh, right? This constant action, right? That we should be engaging and practicing with ourselves and others, right? In all our relations. And we want to now take that and look at a lens, right? So I'm going to ask us to put like our glasses, our goggles on or whatever, because I'm going to ask us to look through the world through a specific lens called the community cultural wealth model. And what's really great about this is we're going to do some practices together, right? So that we can kind of ground ourselves in what this is, okay? Let me just set this in context and just honor, our intentionality and, of course, a really important scholar, Tarayoso, who brought this wealth model to light, right? In understanding this, right? So our intention in using this cultural wealth model as a lens, okay? If you take in La Quech and we're centering the most marginalized in our communities, okay? We're gonna use a cultural wealth model centering the most marginalized, right? But in fact, we're going to look at the most marginalized in our community as assets. What are they bringing to our community that we might not be actually, honoring, right? Utilizing, right? Paying back as such, right? So our intention here is to using the cultural wealth model is an entry point to the humanizing practices within community. Think about this model as an entry point, okay? In fact, Curtis and I have used this model so much, it like lives in our DNA. When we walk into schools, into our classrooms as such, it's just, we're not putting the goggles on anymore. We've practiced it so much, we've retrained our brains, right? To really deepen our own humanity while we're working with our youth, for example, right? Using the community cultural wealth model is a way to build authentic relationships between providers and community members. Authentic is the key word, not aesthetic. Authentic is having a political clarity or political consciousness and understanding the folks you're working with, right? What are those folks up against, right? Building authentic relationships centers that political clarity, right? If we're thinking about working with our immigrant communities, right? We need to really have an understanding of immigrant policy, right? Xenophobic policies, right? As such, right? That in itself deepens authentic relationships, for example, right? And finally, using the cultural wealth model leads to deeper practices of equity, okay? I'm just centering where we're going now, okay, in terms of using this model. I'm gonna present the model in a sec. Let me just honor the person who brought this model to light, right? Tarayoso wrote a landmark book study around education, in particular in the Los Angeles area. The title of the book was Critical Race Counter Stories Along the Chicano Educational Pipeline, right? Curtis was just talking about critical race theory. Tarayoso centers critical race theory in this conversation. She does a study, right? And finds, as Curtis was sharing earlier, that out of 100 Latinx students, you know, more or less, and this was decades ago, but the data is still showing that about half or under half are graduating high school, all the way up to only about 0.5 Latinas, right, are achieving a PhD, right? There is a system intact not allowing certain particular demographics of students not achieving that type of success, right? So she does a study, and in her study, she finds some incredible stuff that she takes us from a deficit to an asset model, meaning no longer are we going to look at our students, for example, in this study, right? And then we can talk about our most marginalized, right, as liabilities, right? But we're looking at them as, damn, they are bringing high level value, right? We call that wealth, right? So Tarayoso conceptualizes community cultural wealth as a critical race theory, challenging traditional interpretations of cultural capital, shifting the lens away from a deficit view of communities of color as places of disadvantage to focus on them as places of cultural knowledge. She suggests that marginalized students of color bring knowledges into the classroom with them that schools must commit to acknowledging and supporting. And by acknowledging and supporting, and Curtis and I can attest to this through our own practice, transformation occurs. Right? When we talk about the classroom, because Curtis and I are teachers at heart, transformation meant grade point averages. Transformation meant frowns to smiles. Transformation meant applying to colleges. Transformation meant to finding our students the resources that were going to change their very lives for the rest of their lives and breaking cycles, right? Of inequities that our students face. We saw it happened right in front of us, right? We provided a space for them to nourish and transform, right? So we're asking us to use this same model, and apply it to the community at large, applying it within your own practice, applying it within your own organization, right? So Tara Yoso takes, she's no longer interested in income, okay? We know income is like the dollars we receive, that paycheck that we might be getting paid this week for, right? The salaries, the raises and payments. And by no means, that's like part of material conditions. But if, you know, and that is what we're committed to transforming, making sure material conditions are provided in equitable ways for all people. Tara Yoso looks at wealth very much differently, right? Okay, wealth is the total extent of an individual's accumulated assets and resources. Okay, want us to focus on resources. What are the resources that we all bring to our community? What are the resources that our most marginalized bring to our community? What wealth do they already carry? Right? So let's look at these wealths, okay? There are seven. Okay, and we're gonna look at each seven. We're gonna define them, okay? We're gonna practice six of the seven, okay? We're gonna define all of them, but we're gonna actually practice all seven. And then later after break, you're gonna actually use this in centering your own community, okay? So Curtis is gonna share a Padlet link in a moment, okay? This is where we're gonna get, this is where I ask for your patience, okay? Because we're gonna define each cultural wealth, right? Starting with aspirational wealth. I'm gonna define it, I'm gonna provide an example, and then I'm gonna ask you a question that you're gonna answer in a Padlet link that Curtis will share in a moment. We don't wanna share it quite yet because we're trying to be good teachers by not giving you something that you don't necessarily need right now, okay? Because we know if you're like me, I'm gonna be like, oh, I wanna see that now, right? So allow me to first introduce the first wealth, aspirational wealth, and to provide an example. And then we will ask you the question that you will answer in Padlet. And Curtis will go over Padlet and all that. We're gonna walk slowly through all this, okay? So let's begin, all right? Aspirational wealth. The ability to maintain hopes and dreams for the future, even in the face of barriers. The ability to maintain hopes and dreams for the future, even in the face of barriers, right? When I think about aspirational wealth, I think of our African-American community. Centuries of aspiration in the face of barriers. I think about Black Lives Matter as one of the highest levels of aspirational wealth in our community, right? When we think about In Lakech, right? Black Lives Matter, right? Even in the face of barriers, the aspiration that our people carry. That's an example of aspirational wealth, the ability to maintain hopes and dreams for the future, even in the face of barriers. So here's the question we want to ask you, okay, that you're going to use in the Padlet. What aspirational wealth do you contribute to your community? Before we ask you to think about all those in your community, we want to center each of you. And we want you to think about the aspirational wealth that you carry, that you bring to your community, okay? I'm going to pass it to Curtis, who's going to explain Padlet now.
Okay, everyone. So I'm going to post the link now, and then I'm going to share my screen and show you what you should be seeing. All right, there's that. And then you'll see, Carlos, you can see the Padlet?
Yes.
All right. So you'll see that aspirational wealth is our first, you know, the first column. And so to answer your question, name the wealth that you bring to your community in the following categories, which is what Carlos just asked us to do. Carlos, you might want to put that question in the chat, but what, you know, so think about your aspirational wealth of your community. I'm sorry, that you bring. What do you aspire for your community? And what you do is you click the plus sign, and then you can name yourself if you want, and then you can write about your aspirational wealth. if you can spell.
Judy.
All right. So, and then you just post it.
I logged in and then I sent
it. And you're good. All right. Oh, see, folks are already doing it. So I'm going to delete my post. And then you all can get busy on the Padlet there. You can see Kim Bender, Dora Estrada. We got some folks already jumping in. So think about your aspirational wealth. And I'm going to stop sharing. There you go.
We have Padlet experts. I shared the definition of aspirational wealth and the question in the chat box. Okay, take a moment to answer that. We are practicing it right now by centering you.
Yeah, so to answer Sarah's question, yeah, it's personal this time because we're building, we're doing the teacher thing, we're scaffolding little stair steps. We're gonna start thinking about community later, but start with yourself.
If anyone has any questions, feel free to unmute yourself to ask for a question.
I'm not totally sure I understand how to start with myself when the definition is, what do we contribute to our community? I'm just a little confused.
Yeah, Tina, thank you for that great question. So thinking about even your own barriers that you may face as a human being, right? Do you carry aspirational wealth? Do you, are you still maintaining particular hopes and dreams for your future, even in the face of barriers? If so, right, if you do, what is that? What aspiration do you carry, right? And if you don't, which is also real, right, then you don't need to answer it, or you can answer it by sharing. Like right now, I'm not very wealthy in my aspiration. You know, I know there's times where I'm feeling super hopeless in our country, right? So, but I think it's somewhere there for you, Tina. You know, did that make sense? I can't see you or hear you, Tina.
And I'm also, yeah. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. And I got a suggestion I received, said, why don't I share the screen so everyone can, you can see what your neighbors are putting down here as well.
You know, when we think about aspirational wealth, this leads us to intersectionality, you know, where we know some groups and demographics of people in our country are facing deeper barriers than others. Right. And so that's where we want to get to a place of later after break, is thinking about your community and the most marginalized, and having an understanding of like, wow, there's still aspirational wealth that even our most marginalized carry. In fact, they may be carrying deep wealth of aspiration, right? Being faced with so many barriers of inequities. Right now, we're just kind of practicing. We're thinking about ourselves, okay? And I think I'm going to move us to the next one, if that's okay. Okay, so we'll see how I'm doing with the rhythm of time, but we're gonna spend the next couple of hours doing this, right? We're gonna give you actually all the definitions of each wealth, okay? So
and if you're struggling. Go ahead and, like with Padlet, go ahead and put it in the chat. Just name the wealth and go ahead and put it in there. And you know, that way you feel like you're contributing. Because I know some folks might be struggling with different web browsers and different technological needs. And so anyway, just there's always an option of using the chat too. Anyway, thanks for your money.
Thank you. So let me go ahead and share screen again, because now we're going to practice a next one, okay? So the next one is linguistic wealth. Intellectual and social skills learned through communication experiences in more than one language and or style, okay? Thinking about all the milagroses out there that are bilingual, trilingual, right? Thinking about our youth that speak youth language. They carry a linguistic wealth, right? Right? Various forms of communication, right? So we're now thinking about this using by centering linguistic wealth, okay? I want to share an example, okay? By Denise Frohman, okay? I'm going to share a video of how she's describing her mother, okay? By using a linguistic wealth definition, okay? So now I'm going to stop sharing that, and I'm going to reshare the video clip, okay? Let me go ahead and actually put the definition of linguistic wealth. Here is a definition of linguistic wealth in the chat box as you're watching the video. Okay. And let's check it out. Okay. This is called accents. Curtis, can you give me a thumbs up that you can see the screen? Thank you. I want to make sure that we have subtitles set up. Should be set. Give me one sec to reset that.
My mom holds her accent like a shotgun with two good hands. Her tongue, all brass knuckled, slipping in between her lips. Her hips are all laughter and wind clap. She speaks a sancocho of Spanish and English pushing up and against one another in rapid fire. See, there is no telling my mama to be quiet. My mama don't know quiet. Her voice is one size better fit all. And you best not tell her to hush. She waited too many years for her voice to arrive to be told it needed housekeeping. See, English sits in her mouth remixed, so strawberry becomes estrawberry. And cookie becomes a cookie. And kitchen, keychain, and chicken all sound the same. My mother doesn't say yes. She says, aha. And suddenly the sky in her mouth becomes a Hector Lavoe song. Her tongue can't lay itself down flat enough for the English language. It got too much hip, too much bone, too much gong, got too much cuatro to two-step, got too many piano keys in between her teeth. It got too much clave, too much hand clap, got too much south side to sit still. It's be an anxious child wanting to make Play-Doh at a concrete English. Be too neat for her kind of wonderful. Her words spill in conversation between women whose hands are all they got. Sometimes our hands are all we got, and accents that remind us that we are still bomba, still plena. You say huepa.
Huepa.
You say huepa.
Huepa.
And a stranger becomes your hermano. You say dale.
Dale.
And a crowd becomes a family reunion. My mother's tongue is a telegram from her mother decorated with the coquis of El Campo. So even when her lips can barely stretch themselves around English, her accent is a stubborn compass, always pointing her towards home.
So, oops. Give me one sec to change that.
Okay. We could change the world as every day we talk.
Okay, y'all. Sorry, I'm going through a couple different screens here. My apologies. Curtis, you want to take over with the Padlet practice again?
Absolutely. Yeah, you all are getting a preview of what's to come. So if you go back to the Padlet, now you'll see, and here I'll share my screen. You'll see that we have the linguistic wealth right here. So go ahead and write down your name again, if you know, and also the linguistic wealth that you bring to your community. And for instance, yeah, go ahead, Carlos. No, you go ahead.
Question in the chat box: what linguistic wealth do you bring to your community? Okay, think about communication in all styles. Okay.
Like I command an incredible basketball vernacular that I can go probably onto any court in America and be able to survive with what I know and how to talk. Now my skills have atrophied horribly, so it give away it would give away that I don't have the same abilities, but at least I could talk it. So I put Gen Z down. That's good. Absolutely.
Oh, that's good.
Millennial. Yeah, smart. Yep. You see gay, lesbian, transgender. There's definitely particular ways of communicating within our groups, within our identities. All right, so I'm gonna stop sharing unless folks want me to keep sharing. This is some beautiful stuff, y'all.
Okay, y'all, I'm gonna keep us going, okay? So feel free to continue to add to the Padlet. And again, you are going to get these definitions after break, but we're just doing some practice, okay? Let me share screen. All right, Curtis, can I get a thumbs up? You can see screen.
You're good.
Thank you. Okay, so the next wealth is navigational wealth, okay? I'm getting a little bit faster here. There's the definition in the chat box. The ability to make our way through social institutions and public spaces not created with us in mind. Navigational wealth, okay? There are systems that are created with, in particular, when we think about our BIPOC community, that have been created with not them in mind, on purpose, right? And we can say there are many systems not created with humans in mind, actually, right? Even though they are for humans, they end up not being very humanizing, right? So navigational wealth, okay, really applies for all of us, right? So here's a story. I wanna share a story, okay? I'm gonna be brief about this story. I wanna share a story about a program that I was a co-founder and I developed over the last 8 years called the Legacy Youth Project. We developed this program in Napa Valley where we centered Chicano males. Actually, these males right here were the founders, the youth founders of our program, okay? Our district came to me and said, we do not know how to serve particular demographics of students in our district. Can you please help, right? And what they were talking about, they called them at risk, but as Curtis shared earlier, we never look at our students at risk, they're at promise. At risk is the conditions that are set up in society where our youth have to navigate, right? So we came to these youth who were averaging probably about, if I remember correctly, 0.5 to 1.0 GPAs. These youth right here were the most marginalized, right? School was not designed for them and they knew it, right? And they responded by not knowing it, right? By knowing it wasn't designed for them, right? So we created this program that began to flourish immediately because we use an ethnic studies framework where we grounded ourselves in Inlaquech, okay? And by that meaning grade point averages did go up. Social emotional skills we supported them for them to develop that confidence, self-esteem, right? As such, right? Seeing themselves in the world, okay? Right? Here's a picture of them 6 months later wearing their program shirts that they created, right? They even created the logo and it was them. That's them. That's our logo, okay? But something occurred 2 years after this, after we were like, you know, flying high, getting all the awards. Oh my gosh, this program is incredible, transformational stuff. Something occurred 2 years later. This person occurred, Brenda Hernandez. Brenda Hernandez walked into our classroom during lunchtime, as many of our students would. And I noticed her for about a month, kind of walking around, looking at stuff. And one of my strategies as a teacher is kind of wait to see if students, you know, come to me and ask me questions, kind of measure their advocacy or measure their where they're at, right? Well, Brenda Hernandez, this person right here, walked around our classroom for about a month, and I was noticing her, you know, from my desk and stuff. And then after about a month, she came up to me, and this is what she said. She said, "Who are you?" Just like that. "Who are you?" And I said, "I'm Carlos. Who are you?" I said it just like that too. And she said, "I'm Brenda." And she walked away. And as she's walking away, I said, "Nice to meet you, Brenda." She comes back the next day. She comes back the next day, right? About a week later, she comes up to me. She's like, "What are you all doing in this class, Carlos?" I said, "Good question, Brenda. You know, we provide our students with, academic support. We provide them with a curriculum for so that they're learning about their own identities as Chicanos, right? You know, but Brenda, if you really want to know what we do, you're more than welcome to come to class and check it out." No joke, Brenda came to our class during fifth period. I do not know what class she was cutting, but she was cutting a class because she came to our class and sat in the back of the room for about a month, analyzing what we were doing, right? She identified as female. All the other students identified as males. She was the only female in the classroom. And it was the quietest month I've ever witnessed of Brenda Hernandez, but she was just watching, taking it all in. Right? Navigating a classroom that was not designed for her, right? And after about a month, she came up to me, she said, "Why aren't girls in this class?" I said, "Because we created this class for young men, for boys." She's like, "Well, I don't think that's fair." I said, "I think you're right." And she said, "What are you gonna do about it?" And I said, "Nothing. What are you gonna do about it?" And that's a moment of pedagogy because I knew that something was in her, aspirational wealth, that no matter what happened, she was going to do something about it. So I was kind of testing her, right? So I get a phone call that night from the principal. He calls me and says, "Carlos," usually this is what principals say, right? If they're worried about something, "Carlos, we have a problem." First thing he said, I said, "Yes, Mike, what's the problem?" He says, "Well, Brenda Hernandez and a group of her student, of her peers, of her sisters, came, charged into my office, demanding that they have access to the Legacy Youth Project." I said, "Wow, Mike, Brenda's pretty amazing leadership there. That's amazing leadership." He says, "Yeah, well, we got to do something about it because this is an issue of equity." I said, "Mike, you are so right. Let's do something about it. Let's make sure that our program is opened up for all genders." He says, "Okay, let's do this." So that's what we did. And in fact, this is the picture that you're seeing. Oops, excuse me. The picture here is year one when all genders were included, right? In fact, there's Brenda again, as I shared earlier. She's frowning because she was mad because she didn't want to be in the picture, but I made her be in the picture, right? But she loved Legacy. So she, you know, I knew she would get in the picture, but she would just show her style, right? And so her and her friends, her peers, demanded, right, that they enter the Legacy Youth Project, right? They navigated a school system that wasn't designed for them. In fact, they navigated a program that wasn't designed for them, right? So when they got into the program, they said, "What are you gonna do about the logo?" And we said, "What are you talking about? We have a great logo." They're like, "No, you don't. We're not in it." And we're like, "Yes, you're right. You're not in it." So they got their logo. And then we combined both logos, right? One of the only smiles I ever saw Brenda, right? She even made her own Legacy t-shirt. Had to be tie-dye because she always wanted to be different. And she put the logo on her shirt. Brenda had the ability to make way through social institutions and public spaces that weren't created for her. Okay. So we want to ask you, y'all. What What navigational wealth do you? Yes, all feels love for Brenda, for sure. Yes, no doubt. I love that. What navigational wealth do you bring to your community? Okay, so here's the question. Okay, so think about that, y'all, right? Think about systems that were not designed for you, right? We could name even when I walk into hospitals, I don't feel like it was designed for me, for example, right? It's a very complicated system. I'm like, I don't, you know, right? So think about some systems or places that you feel weren't designed for you, right? Use an intersectional lens, right? Think about age, think about ability, right? Think about language, right? Think about curriculum, right? Think about different systems, right? Give you a moment. And if you have any questions, please ask.
I see that a lot of you love the Brenda story. Yeah, it's one of my favorites too. There's some good stuff here, y'all. Working within the county governmental clinical system as someone who identifies as a peer. Looks to communicate. I don't know, that one's probably still being written, sorry. Oh, here we go. Riley wrote, often the youngest in professional setting, neurodiverse, queer. Alegria said, I went to college and played sports and I work in local government and I'm a lawyer. Think about all the navigation there. Dora, first generation Latinx college graduate, help friends, neighbors, siblings navigate getting a higher education. Yeah, awesome. Let me scroll down a little further. Helping folks, Nicole said, helping folks navigate to begin with. Often they don't know resources are even there. Yeah. Helen said leadership roles as a young woman. Awesome.
Beautiful.
Jenny C said writing. I help young people write their resumes, learn from others before me and now passing it on. All right. Love it. Pay it forward. Great.
Beautiful, y'all. We're going to continue on with our next wealth. We have a few more that we want to share. Get us to a 10 o'clock break. So I'm going to share our next wealth and I'm going to put it in the chat box already. Getting faster and faster. This is familial wealth. Cultural knowledge is nurtured among familia, kin, that carries a sense of community, history, memory, and cultural intuition. We're going to ask one of our most respected elders, Jerry Theo, who does incredible work, to share a story, a familial wealth story that he carries. Okay. So I'm going to go now to that story. Okay. And Curtis, you can see the screen. Great. Here we go. So think about familial wealth, the definitions in the chat box.
I truly believe we could change the world. We could change the world if every day we told every child, you're a blessing. Now I'm talking about the kids, the ones that kind of flow with us and those travieso kids that don't flow with us. You know, those kids that challenge every move, the ones that are always moving like this. What's the matter with you? You gotta go to the bathroom? No, nothing. You know, when you sleep with them, they kick you in the head. The one that sit in the classroom, they're always leg moving. You know, sit down, Johnny, stop. You're moving the table. Okay. And the other leg moves like this. And what's the matter? Nothing. And they're always moving. Those kids that just, you know, challenge everything. You know, they mess up your classroom, mess up your everything, right? Those kids are blessings too. They just can't sit because they flow, and sometimes their energy is about seeing colors and seeing dimensions and seeing rhythms and moving in a syncopated way, you know, and their emotion is something that is deeper, that sees beyond, that sees through, that sees in, that sees throughout, and a classroom is too confining for them, a piece of paper is too confining for them. They have to think larger, and that larger sense just begins to spew out and then makes them, they can't sit still. But in growing up in that community, where my parents met in Texas, we moved to South Central Los Angeles, where Mexicanos lived with African Americans on this side of the municipal airport. And the other side of the municipal airport was a whole different world. Mama said, no vas para allá, don't go over there. Why can't we go over there? You play here. We want to go over there. No, you stay here. But we want to go in that park. It's bigger. No, stay here. But that park got grass, because we don't have no grass in our park, you know? I mean, you know, we didn't know the different investment in different communities, you know, already. And how many of our young people do we see doing risky behavior and we think, what's the matter with you? What kind of decision is that? Maybe they're tired. Maybe they're lonely. Maybe they're sleepy. Maybe they're hopeless. Not because they're stupid. Not because they're unmotivated. Not because they don't want to do good. Not because they don't have a vision. Not because they don't have a passion. Maybe they're just tired. And as I'm standing there in the park, thinking about how I might be able to take myself out, the weirdest thing happened to me. I smelled something. See, my grandma used to wear what I thought was a stinky powder called maja. And I smelled maja. And I smelled my grandma. My grandma's been dead for I don't know how many years. And I'm smelling her and I said, dude, why am I smelling my grandma? I'm not even high or nothing. What's up? And it's like, and I smelled my grandma. And then I remembered every day that she would bless me. And before I went to school, she would say, Mico, tú eres una bendición, you're a blessing. And that God doesn't make junk. That every child that comes in this world is a blessing. Y tú vas a hacer algo muy bonito para la gente. You're going to do something beautiful for your people. And she inoculated me with her serum of spirit. She inoculated me with her hope. She inoculated me with her vision. She inoculated me with the spirit of my people. Because she knew there was going to be times when not only was I not going to feel like a blessing, I was going to feel like the mistake. She knew that there was going to be times when I was going to feel like I was a presenting problem. She knew that I was going to be made to feel like I was the high risk factor, like I was the immigrant, like I was the illegal, like I wasn't wanted, like I was the one that was contributing to the demise of a community. She knew there was going to be times when I walked in, people were not only going to not think I was a blessing, they were going to think I was the problem, they were going to grab their purse, they were going to check me out, they were going to follow me with security. She knew that the society would try and destroy me and put in my head that I was not worthwhile and people like me were not worthwhile. And when you put in somebody's head they're not worthwhile, they will destroy people that look like them. So she inoculated me with his spirit to remind me that I'm a blessing. I want to thank you for being here and challenge you really to step up and step through, to reach out, ask for what you need, but recognize that all of you are a blessing. You're all a blessing on this way and we're all interconnected. In my Nahuatl language, we call it encloque nahuaque, meaning we're all interconnected. Where one of us hurts, we all hurt. Where one of us succeeds, we all succeed. Where one of us rises, we all rise. Thank you, God bless you.
Powerful, y'all. So you can hear through his grandmother's story, the familial wealth, right? So we're going to ask you the question of, okay, what familial wealth do you bring to your community? What familial wealth do you bring to your community?
Some really beautiful stuff that you're all contributing. Jared Dale tends to choke me up, so that's why I was a little quiet.
Thank you all for contributing to that. I'm gonna now bring us to our next one. We have three more, and I think I can get us to 10 o'clock by going over the last three. I am gonna cut a video out, but I'll, you know, we'll include these videos when we send our slide deck your way. So allow me to share the next wealth. This one is resistance wealth. I'm gonna put the definition also in the chat box. Knowledges and skills cultivated through behavior that challenges inequality. Knowledges and skills cultivated through behavior that challenges inequality, right? You know, even thinking about that story about Brenda, you know, she was challenging, you know. I think most teachers would have probably looked at Brenda as like, she has a really negative, bad attitude and get out of my class, you know. And I was like, whoa, Brenda is not only a leader, but her resistance wealth is incredible, right? We need that resistance wealth to change systems. Right. Okay. So I'm not going to share this beautiful video of Edna Chavez when she was in high school, when the youth came together on a national front against gun violence, right? In, you know, supporting gun legislation, right? But we will share this amazing speech that she gives, right? When she's a senior in high school. She's from Compton, and she gave an incredible speech. But in just in terms of time, I just want to honor our break, because I know that you know, we've been on for a while. I did want to make sure that to let you know that we do have a great example from her about that, right? In the same context, I'm going to ask us to just pause on the Padlet, but would love at some point for you to add, what resistance wealth do you bring to your community, right? Okay. But for time's sake, I'm just going to ask us to hold on to that, okay? So the last two, in fact, just move some slides over. Okay. The next one, just again for just going over each one. And then after the break, we're actually going to just review this as you apply it, is social wealth, networks of people and community resources that contribute to your success. Okay. We'll also share this wonderful music video by Las Cafeteras. Song called Mujer Soy. And you'll see in this video how this person carries a high level of social wealth, right? Okay. We're not talking, you know, we carry social wealth. All of us here carry social wealth, right? Think about the people at the margins, what type of social wealth they carry, right? It's incredible once we center that, right? Same thing, the question was, what social wealth do you bring to your community, right? You can answer that later, right? But I do want to end this portion of today with ancestral wealth. Cultural knowledge is rooted in ancestry that carry a sense of community, history, memory, cultural intuition, responsibility, and guidance. I'm going to take us to a conversation between the great Maya Angelou and Dave Chappelle. And they're talking about ancestral wealth. Okay. Let me just make sure I have everything set up.
And I'll add these questions to the Padlet, so that you all can get to it later, so you remember the language that Carlos was asking.
Ancestral wealth, here we go.
cursing. Like, you could think with MailChimp's marketing smarts, you get a whole lot of creep.
Sorry about that. Okay.
Appreciate that life is a linear journey. So, you know, what's it going to be about?
One of the things I've learned, or am even still in process of learning, is to don't pick it up and don't lay it down. When someone says, you're the best, you're the greatest, you're the most wonderful, you're the finest and the artist of the time and blah, blah, you say, ah. If you pick that up, you also have to pick it up when they say, you're nothing, you lost it, you used to be, and what happened? So I don't pick it up, I don't lay it down. Let me tell you why. Let me say why now. John Singleton was doing his movie, Poetic Justice, and he asked, would I come out to Los Angeles and do a cameo? I walked out of my trailer that morning, and there was one young man cursing, like you could see the blue come out of his mouth. And then he and another fellow, they were at each other's throats. They had each other's clothes. So I went up to one young man and I said, excuse me, may I speak to you? He said, I wouldn't give, I said, I understand that. But may I speak to you for a minute? He said, if these move, I said, uh-huh. I've heard that before. But do you know how important you are? Do you know that our people slept, lay spoon fashion in the filthy hatches of slave ships, in their own and in each other's excrement and urine and menstrual flow so that you could live 200 years later? Do you know that? Do you know that our people stood on ocean blocks so that you could live? He said, I said, no, but I just wonder, when's the last time anyone told you how important you are? And he started to, the tears started to come out. I had no Kleenex or anything, so I just wiped his face with my hands and talked to him. And Miss Janet Jackson came. She says, Los Angelo, I don't believe you actually talked to Tupac Shakur. I didn't know Tupac Shakur. I didn't know Six Pack. I had never heard the name. Because in my life and my age group, you understand? I didn't know that. Tupac's mother wrote me a letter. She said her son had called her right after I had spoken to him. And she wanted to thank me. She said, you may have saved his life. And I thank you, Dr. Angelo.
In that one story, she painted a more human picture of him than the entire media did. There.
I'm going to pause that. So very powerful conversation, very humanizing conversation. You can even see the familial wealth that, Dr. Angelo and Dave Chappelle are connecting with. And she centers their ancestry, right? Ancestral stories, right? In that conversation. She didn't even know who Tupac Shakur was, right? And so you can, reflect upon that, right? What ancestral wealth do you contribute to your community, right? That's our last question for the Padlet discussion, right? But we want to honor break. Y'all, thank you so much for engaging in this first part of the community of cultural wealth. We're going to come back at 10:16. Where we're going to ask you to begin mapping out your community using the cultural wealth model. Okay, thank you so much, y'all. Thank you.
Turn this one up.
Thank you. studio's the poison. My black news for rejoicing. Now when you start it's rising, I've heard my blessings. That I'm safe and I'm resting. Furniture in the nesting. Not by force, I'm suggesting. You're going to blessings. I've got love and assurance. I've got new health insurance. I've got strength and endurance. So I've got my blessings. And give thanks to the Lord that you are the disaster. We're still here together after. Better count your blessings.
Count your blessings. It's your this year. Can't wait till it gets here. 7:21 on my first song will shine. And it's amazing. I'm about to be raising another name. And like his dad, they'll praise him. And some will hate him. Just cause we're building a nation. Like Bob did the game. Yeah, the world will embrace him. Girls will chase him. We'll see they will not break him. And when I'm not around, you'll forgot it. Thank
I've
you.
I've got some words to dress for. And I've got no need to stress for. And so I'll always put my best foot. And tell my blessings. And there's no need for tissues. There's nothing no further issues. If you've got someone who miss you, then count your blessings. And I've got love and assurance. And I've got new health insurance. And I've got strength and endurance. So I've got my blessings. And you thanks to the master. That you were the disaster. We're still here together after. Better count your blessings.
You were sitting in the top position. Picture perfect, not a mess cause you deserve it. Without the Hermes, you never heard it. You knew that you was destined for greatness, pursuing. You see the overzealous, they be thirsting. Caught up in emotion, you keeping your composure like Gershwin. Songs by my friend, keep you in his own right in person. So when your pockets like you bet you have a heavy purpose.
That's in school and daycare. We've got pension and welfare. And though not all you play the game fair, still I got my blessings. I've got joy and abundance. I've got life full of substance. I've got meetings and functions. So I've got my blessings. I've got something to live for. I've got surplus to give more. And we're all welcome to his door. So I've got my blessings. And he said.
Okay, y'all, I did have to pause that wonderful song just to honor our time. Welcome back, everyone. Hope you had a little bit of some breathing time, stretching time, bathroom time, snack time, just moment to breathe, moment to reflect, or maybe answer 20 emails, 20 text messages, or, you know, all of that stuff that we do. So welcome back, y'all. I did share the two videos that, because of time, I couldn't share. And so one of them by Edna Chavez, centering resistance wealth. And the other one by a really beautiful music group, Las Cafeteras from Los Angeles. They have a beautiful song called Soy Mujer and a beautiful video, really centering social wealth in that. We'll make sure all these videos that we've shared today also are included in the, along with the slides that we'll get to you all. We do want to now go into part two of the community cultural wealth model, right? The first part was really looking at the definitions and going through some practices, right? Some swings around what that may look like for yourself, right? And really reflecting on that. Now we're going to turn to and transfer and use the community cultural wealth model to think about your community, right? So this is the part where we're going to get in groups, not quite yet, but we will. You will do your breakout groups, but I wanted to share a case study where we're going to ask you, we're going to quiz you, y'all, right? Okay, no grades, we don't do grades, right? Talk about inequity and equity, right? But we are going to ask you a couple questions to answer in the chat box in conversation with this case study that I'm going to share now, okay? So I'm going to get us in. Before I do we're good on time. If there's any major announcements that need to be made, no? Okay. All right, y'all. So we're going to get into this get into part two of the community cultural wealth model. And this part, right here are the definitions. In fact, this slide right here is going to be shared with you. If it can be shared now, actually, you should be able to receive a link in the chat box where you are now going to have these definitions. There you go. Thank you so much, Leah, for sharing that. So those are the definitions of the cultural wealth, right? You know, look at Tara Yoso's work around these definitions. Ancestral wealth, we've added that, right? You know, so that's not necessarily part of Tara Yoso's. And with that said, in fact, there are other wealths that we could be including in this, right? You know, and so think about that. What are the other wealths in your own community, right? Being community responsive, right? But just wanted, you know, I think this is a really wonderful start, you know, in using this as lens work in engaging with your community in the fight against inequity, right? So as I shared, we're gonna use these definitions and we're gonna do a case study, okay? And the case study is the community that I live in, right? Your neighbor, right? This, in fact, this image is probably shared Sonoma Napa Valley land, right? And so what a wonderful community that I live in. What a wonderful community that you all live in, right? If we're neighbors as such, right? And I want to use Napa, I want to use my community as a case study, right? In fact, we're going to even look at another one of my former students as a really high level example of cultural wealth, right? But in thinking about the Napa Valley, right, I want to just share a few data points that probably will resonate with you pretty well, given that Sonoma County also has a high dependency on tourism, right? Given the wine industry and the you know, the overall tourist industry, right? Napa County visitors in 2015 spent $1.27 billion, an increase of 8.9% over the year before, the highest percentage gain among all 9 Bay Area counties. $1.27 billion, right? That came out in 2015 in our local paper, right? A year before, an article came out titled, "Is Napa Rich or Poor? Reports Paint Vastly Different Images." Okay, here are some quotes from these different analysis, right? A study issued in October by Stanford University and the Public Policy Institute of California made the case for Napa having an unusually high percentage of low-income people. Having an unusually high percentage of low-income people. It's interesting, given the what that slide, the previous slide, right? The same month, a Wall Street Journal website called 24/7 Wall Street portrayed Napa as an oasis of affluence. Citing federal statistics, the Wall Street Journal said Napa County was America's 10 richest out of 318 metropolitan statistical areas. That same Stanford report, right? Public Policy Institute study said Napa County has one of the highest poverty rates in the state, when factoring in the cost of housing, medical expenses, and other social assistance programs. This was in 2014. I know, like Napa, Sonoma, when it comes to the health, I mean, when it comes to the, well, the health, of course, but also the housing has only gotten worse, right? What's this about, y'all? When we think about Napa, right? You know, when you think about Sonoma County, right? When people outside of our counties think about Napa, this is what they think about, right? And these are real images. This does exist in Napa, right? We have a wonderful Oxbow Market. Downtown has been redeveloped, right? I'm sharing the dominant narrative of Napa right now, right? That now there's a huge hotel in there, right? But anytime there's these machine-like Star Wars, you know, cranes, right? There's concern, in particular for our marginalized community, because this is called development for some, right? And an exit for most, right? Napa has transformed over the last 10 years. Yes, Michael, building the Death Star. Thank you. Love it. Right? We now have these really beautiful hotels downtown, right? 10 years ago, the youth I was working with and many community members that I was working with were able to go to downtown, for example, Thursday nights for local nights, right? Those type of functions no longer exist because downtown has been transformed, centering tourism, right? Centering alcohol, right? Here's Google, right? Napa Valley, look at all these images that come up. You know, you can go on and on and on, right? This is the dominant narrative, the dominant story of Napa, right? Well, back to this image, right? There's Brenda, our famous Brenda Hernandez. Next to Brenda is Giovanni Castro, okay? And I want to introduce Giovanni Castro by having him teach us a little bit about the cultural wealth model, okay? I was asked during this time to give a talk. It was during Latinx Heritage Month. Oftentimes during that month, many Latinx people get asked to speak on behalf of the entire Latinx population in the world. You know, so I was asked to give a, I was asked by one of our local museums to give a talk around Latinx art, And I quickly said yes, trying to learn how to slow down by not saying quickly yes, but I quickly said yes. And I hung up, I said, huh, that's a weird yes I just gave because I'm not an artist. I'm Chicano, but that doesn't make me a Chicano artist. And I don't know, you know, everything about art. So I said, yes, I made the commitment. So I started going down my, you know, artistic knowledge. So I went quickly to Diego Rivera. That's a default, right? Wonderful artist. No, I mean, you know, amazing. Then I was like, okay, if I talk about Diego, I have to talk about Frida Kahlo. Okay. So then I was like, all right, but what about like maybe California stuff? All right, let me talk about Chicano Park in San Diego, right? Maybe some murals in LA, right? All to say, I didn't have much to contribute. My knowledge around Latin American, Latinx art is limited. I appreciate it, but it's limited, right? So I started putting together this presentation, talking about the kind of the big muralists and such, right? And then I was like, oh my gosh, my students, the cultural wealth of my students, there are so many wonderful artists, right? And I was like, Giovanni Castro. So, there's a better picture of Gio. Gio was one of our youth, actually one of our first youth to be able to apply to CSU, UC eligible. He came from a long story, right, that I don't have time to share, but a long transformative story. Super smart, like all of our youth. And he was a brilliant artist. So I was like, I'm gonna ask Gio to contribute to my talk. So I text messaged Gio. I said, Hermanito, I need you, can you do me a favor? He's like, sure. I'm like, can you draw me a picture of your Napa Valley? He's like, oh, okay. He's like, what do you want? I was like, I want you to draw a picture of your Napa Valley. What does your community look like? He's like, okay, cool. But what do you want me to draw? I said, well, I want you to draw your Napa Valley. He's like, cool. But what? I said, hermano, I don't know what your Napa Valley is because you live you and I live me. What do you see? And you've grown up here. I haven't. He's like, all right, well, I don't really know, but I'll give it a shot. He's like, when do you need it by? I'm like, I need it by like tomorrow morning, dude. And he's like, what? You know, I'm like, it's cool, man. You asked me for that letter of recommendation like 3 days late, you know? So just, you know, we got to get back our youth, right? Teach them lessons. So he said he would do it. And this is what he text messaged me. Take a moment to look at that. A little different than the Google images. Using the cultural wealth model, map out Gio's artwork by identifying wealth that Gio brings to his community. Okay. So let's take a moment. I'm not asking you, I mean, if you want to add in the chat box, you can, but I'm going to ask you two specific questions in about 30 seconds. And I'm going to type those questions in the chat box. But perhaps you can see linguistic wealth in here, maybe resistance wealth, right? Maybe ancestral wealth. Someone said Laurel Street. Yeah, thank you, Stephanie, for honoring Laurel Street. That's the heart of our Raza community. Yeah, familial wealth in here, for sure, right? Yes, beautiful, Alegria, thank you. Okay. here are my two questions. I'm going to bring this art piece right back up, but allow me to unshare for a moment because I need to get those questions. I'm going to get these two questions here. I'm going to put this in the chat box. Okay. And I'm going to bring this image right back up. Oops. Just give me one sec to do this. There are the questions I'd like you to answer, but I'm going to bring up the picture again so you can look at the picture as you're answering these questions. All right. Oops. Darn. Thought I had it. Here we go. Okay. The questions are, okay, how does Gio's artwork humanize who he is, right? And how does Gio's artwork demonstrate his cultural wealth? Cite examples. Many of you have already cited great examples. Social wealth, familial wealth, right? Aspirational wealth, no doubt, right? Okay. And also, how does this picture humanize who he is, right? So just take a moment. Just take a moment to, if you want to add to the chat box, you can. Okay. We're not giving any grades out. Placing himself in the tableau. This is a famous picture now, and believe me, when after Gio put this picture together, all of his peers made him teach this picture to them in class. It was an incredible experience to hear Gio talk about what was going on this image. What are you seeing, Napa, through his eyes? Yes, we are seeing Napa through his eyes. Yes, Lori, thank you. That's a humanizing journey. Seeing something through him. He honors himself as a student who needs and is artistic. Yes, Peter, thank you. Take about 30 more seconds. Yep, I see someone laughing at him. Not sure who that was in there, but if so, it humanizes him in a way I wasn't expecting. Napa is his home where he has placed his cultural roots. Napa is part of his cultural identity. Yes, right? Beautiful, y'all. Thank you so much for sharing this. Okay. Yeah, in lucha, growth, and resistance. Yeah. The Aztec dancer is so beautiful. Yes. Tell us about the laughing figure. Yes, yes. Yeah, the laughing figure. Yeah, that's a hater. Yeah, Gio taught us that was a police officer who his freshman year arrested him, right? And told him he would never be able to do anything. One of the first things I told you all about Gio is he was our first student in our program that was CSU UC eligible. So Gio certainly did something and continues to do something, right? Wanted to end this part because we're going to transition now, but just want to honor Gio. Not only did he transform, but this wonderful, beautiful graduation picture, right? And this was quite long ago. This now Gio's about 22, 23. I can tell by the grays in my beard. So what we're going to do now, y'all, is we're going to actually move us on. Okay. And we're going to talk about mapping as an agent for change, right? Cultural mapping as one significant tool, since if applied wisely, it allows the user to grasp the intangible and invisible through a concrete medium that can be shared with others, okay? We're going to actually ask you, in a moment, you're going to get into community groups, right? Where you're going to engage in a mapping activity, right? Now, I'm not going to say we're limited, but we're not going to be able to go geo style here, right? So for those of you artists that are like, oh my gosh, right? But you might be able to in a creative way, right? When we explain these directions. In the broader context, cultural mapping works to protect and promote cultural diversity, regenerating cultural resources, safeguarding, revitalizing intangible, tangible heritage, culture, advocacy and policy dialogue, right? This is part of the United Nations Education, Scientific and Cultural Organization, right? Okay, just kind of grounding us in the power of mapping, okay? Now, let me pause here. Hermano Curtis, should we go over the directions first, or the rest of the team, should we go over the breakout groups first?
Let's go with the directions. You give folks more time to ask us some questions, and then they'll know where to go after.
Awesome. Can you take this piece over, Hermano?
Absolutely. So everyone, we're gonna break you out into those rooms that we had originally asked you to name yourselves into, to cities or, you know, places that you call home or where you work, right? So those 10 different spots. And what we're gonna do is, those are gonna be breakout rooms where you're gonna be doing this activity together. So you're gonna use the community cultural wealth model that Carlos has presented as a lens. And you're gonna be thinking about, first of all, get to know each other, say hi, introduce yourselves and whatnot. You're gonna be thinking about your community. So the Santa Rosa folks are gonna be thinking about Santa Rosa, the Healdsburg folks are gonna be thinking about Healdsburg. And you're gonna be thinking about not your just yourself now, where we had the Padlet, but your entire community as far as the cultural wealth that you have. So you probably is gonna start out with you all just listing ideas, right? And then you'll build a map from there. Maybe you have an artist in the space who can start this work right away. So I'm going to go over the directions. But before I do that, I'm also going to let you know that we're going to do this over on a Google Jamboard. And this is what it looks like. I'm not going to give you the link to the Jamboards yet. I'm just going to show you. That's right. I can't do it until Carlos is done sharing. No worries. Hold on. Oh, did you already get my thing? Sorry. We did it simultaneously. It was too slick. So you're going to have a Jamboard that looks like this. So this is our Petaluma crew. You're going to get these directions. They look a little different because I didn't have Geo's slide underneath it, but the directions are the same on this page. The directions. So you're going to think about what cultural wealth are present in your wealths are present in your community, keeping in mind the most vulnerable and marginalized neighbors you have. Identify inequities that exist in your community. How does your map align with the concept of Inlakesh? Those are questions I want you to come to later. So let me just start with, you're going to just identify and start mapping out your community with the cultural wealth in mind and keeping the lens right here about identifying the inequities that exist, okay? Once you start, you know, developing a sense of what that can be, what that can look like, you have a map here in your Jamboard. You have all these tools here. This is a pen, this is an eraser, this is the select tool, sticky note, images. So this is where I like, usually Carlos and I give you a big old or a couple sheets of big old, you know, poster paper, and you're able to do it together, right? So this is in lieu of that, since we're still distance. So you might want to think about adding images. So that's actually a positive versus that we don't have when we're doing this in person is, you know, you're doing it freehand, which is beautiful and lovely. And, you know, it can be also very therapeutic and as well, to actually creating your map. But for this, you could actually do a little bit of mixed methods, right? So you could have mixed media, as they say in the art world. You can do a little bit of drawing with this tool, and you can go out and like into the Google space, or if you have pictures on your hard drive, you can go and grab on some images and just drop them in here. Now you can make multiple pages up here. So if your map continues to grow, or you wanna focus on specific neighborhoods or specific wells, whatever, you know, it's your map, you all decide, you can add pages onto this. And then there's text boxes here. I believe there's shapes and circles and all sorts of things like that. So I just wanted to show you like what you're doing. So go ahead and do those first two questions. Then as you get, you know, we're going to give you a big chunk of time. That's the Carlos and I, you know, Carlos, if you have a moment to be thinking about time right now while I do this, that'd be great. So we can like give everyone an idea about how long they're going to get to actually draw it. And then we're going to ask you to like think about how your map aligns with the concept of Enlakech. Okay. Is Enlakech thriving in some areas? Is it under threat? Is it absent? Is it a place where it can be cultivate and grow? And then the last piece is what we would like you all to share out when we bring you all back together. So say maybe 20 minutes left of our time together, which is in about an hour's time. We're going to ask you just to share volunteers in different groups. I don't know if we'll have enough time to do all 10 groups. We'll play that one by ear. But articulate hopes you have for your community and the next steps you can take towards racial equity grounded in the cultural wealth of your community. And I'm sorry, I didn't have a space between the and culture there. yeah, forgive me for that one. So this is the part, along with your map, that you can share with all of us as a next step, as a takeaway, as a way of consolidating and synthesizing all of your discussion and all of your brilliance and analysis about your community, and being able to think about, this is really a next step to what we did last February, which was we asked you to identify where Enlakech was thriving, where it was absent, under threat, or in peril. And now we'd like you to build upon that by actually naming some of the cultural wealth you have, and also looking at spots where it's not being taken advantage of through that Enlakech lens, right? So you have some time to think about all these things, but mostly use Giovanni's mural as inspiration. He names some, like the wealth of the community, and the vineyards can be seen in a lot of different ways, right? Could be like the labor of our gente, the hands in the dirt. It could be seen as the industry, the train. One thing that stood out to me about the train is his peers asked him, why did you put the train in there, the wine train? And he goes, oh, that's the train that always goes through our town that we're never on. So this is a chance for you to really think deeply and create together about what your communities look like, feel like, and something that you can take from here. These jam boards are pretty much yours, and build together across organizations, as neighbors, as a one community in the county, and as one county too. Is that clear? There's some questions. I'll stop sharing for right now. Sorry, one last thing. We would like you to share. So if you could pick somebody or somebodies, we usually, Carlos and I like some type of balance, you know, with voices. We don't want to hear two men's like us, right? Talking at you all the whole time. So if you have some balanced gender or balanced age or balanced, some type of balance would be beautiful in articulating what you all went through and what you're emphasizing, walking us through your map and or summarizing what you all synthesize, what you all learned together through this activity. So if you can make sure that you pick a couple folks, maybe in the beginning stages, to carry that labor. I tell you what, I would volunteer for my group because my artistic skills are really, really awful. So I would use my palabra, to be the skill set that I could share to carry some of the labor of our group. Anybody have any questions? Please throw them in the chat. I'm gonna actually paste all the jam boards in the chat right now.
Curtis, can I do it?
Please do. Yeah.
Yeah,
oh, great. I didn't know you all did it. That's great. That's because I probably would have made a mistake. Yeah.
So just to announce to everyone, Petaluma was combined with Rohnert Park and Cotati because we only had a one Rohnert Park, and Windsor and Healdsburg were combined. And then everyone who didn't select a city is going to stay in the Sonoma County room in Lem, unless you want to select a city. And those that speak Spanish, the interpretation will be happening in the main room. Did I say everything, Aaliyah, that I was supposed to? Good, okay.
Hey, thanks for our team behind the scenes, because we would have messed all that up. So thank you, Leah, and wonderful job. Yeah, so if you need the translation, this is your room. And Carlos and I will try to stay out of your way. We'll mute our buttons and stay out of your way. If you need any help in your breakout rooms, just signal it through Zoom, and Carlos and I will attempt to go and visit.
All right, so do it now. Separate them now. Okay, go for it, John.
Do it now. Just a suggestion to get started is for everyone to have an opportunity to meet each other, introduce yourselves, and move forward together in that way.
Hi, everyone in the main room.
Hi, Leah.
Hi. Are you guys going to get started? Who's going to help facilitate this room?
Leah, can I make an ask to be put in the Windsor-Healdsburg room?
Yes, Monse, yes.
And hello, everybody.
Hi, and this is Ellen. I'd like to go to the Russian River room, please.
I could go to the Santa Rosa room, that would be really great.
Yeah. This is Anna, if I can go to the Santa Rosa one as well.
Yeah.
Can you guys rename yourselves and then we'll work on that?
I got logged off and I just renamed myself when I logged back on.
Okay, thank you. Jonathan, are you hearing all this?
Leah, this is Cynthia. I'd like to go to the Petaluma room.
Okay, Cynthia, just put Petaluma by your name so Jonathan can...
I don't know how to do that.
Oh, you don't know how to rename. Okay, we'll do it. I'll do it for you.
Thank you.
No problem.
This is also Carol West. I got a technical glitch and got kicked off and rejoined. So.
Oh, Carol did? Okay, we'll put you in Petaluma.
Thank you.
Hey, Leah, this is Brian Dufour. I just put Petaluma in my name, if you could transfer me, that would be great. Thank you.
Got it. Thank you.
And excuse me, Russian River, please, for Jeanette.
Hi, Jeanette. I'll see you when we get over there. I'm trying to get over there too.
Okay.
Hi, this is Jenny Chamberlain. There's only two of us in the Cloverdale break room, and Amanda needs to leave early, so we're asking to be transferred to the Windsor-Healdsburg breakout room. Because all the cities are intertwined, but I will end up being by myself in the Cloverdale room. So if you can transfer Amanda Farrar and Jenny Chamberlain to the Cloverdale Hillsborough breakout room. I mean, to the Hillsborough.
Did we get them all? No, Rebecca. Where did you want to be, Rebecca? I can't hear you. We don't have a Napa room. You go to whatever room. I can't hear you. Can you put the city that you want when you rename?
Oh. Leah, I think Ellen in the Russian River, I see her.
Yeah, Jeanette and I are trying to get there. I don't know if she already made it.
Thank you. Okay, where's Ellen on here? Yay, Leah, you're doing a great job, sister. It doesn't say that she's not there, and yet she's still here. Okay. Jonathan, I can't seem to move Ellen. She won't show up on my unassigned list.
I'm here on this group. Can you see me?
Yeah.
Here? Oh.
For some reason, you're not.
Ellen, I'm looking for you right now.
So weird. She's not showing up.
I'm not seeing you. Oh, I believe I probably assigned you. Let's see. Where?
I got assigned to Sebastopol by mistake.
Oh, okay. That's easy enough to track down.
Well, that's why right. I'm over right now.
And also, Isabel, also Lopez, supposed to be in.
Lopez Russian to River. Russian River?
Yeah.
Hit it.
Thank you.
Great. All right, so this room, our link is. Thank you for bearing with us, everyone. Share my screen. All right, can you all see that? Great. Are any of you in there? Oh, it looks like you are. Did you joined it? So.
Oh, Leah. Hi, it's Amanda from Cloverdale.
Hi.
I sent you a chat asking. Okay. Jenny Chamberlain and I were trying to get maybe reassigned to the group with Healdsburg and Windsor.
Okay.
So it was just the two of us, and we feel like the culture is pretty much the same.
So where? I'm sorry. Where did you want to go?
Healdsburg Windsor Group, North Carolina.
Healdsburg Windsor. Okay.
And Jenny Chamberlain, I don't know if you found her. She was going to try to find you too. Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Amanda, it looks like you already have an invite into that room. Can you look to see if you have a breakout on the bottom of your the
oh, okay.
The logos on the bottom. Okay. Click out.
Okay, now, click breakout rooms. Okay, okay, we glitched. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, you got it. Leah was doing that. She's being the breakout room goddess right now.
I hope so. I hope Jenny got where she wanted to go. Okay. For this room, who would like to be the facilitator? Should I just put you all in rooms? Maybe these are all the people that are away from their desks, except me and Bethany. Bethany, do you want me to put you in a room where you'll have people to talk to?
It's okay. It's okay. I'm okay. The path of least resistance. So I'll start, and maybe we can take Carlos's suggestion and have just introduce ourselves, and then that way we know who is available to engage and who's not. Yes. And then we can open up the jam board. But I'm not sure if I have the ability to share the jam board on a mutual screen. That's the only thing I'd ask for, Leah. So okay, I'm Bethany, and I serve as the community engagement manager for Regional Parks, and I'm really happy to be here with you all.
I am, oh goodness, everything right now. My iPad's dying and everyone is texting me. I'm Leah Benz. I work for the Department of Health Services. I love you, Bethany. It's so lovely to see your face. I'm with you in this room, but I also have to like troubleshoot a bunch of stuff right now. So I'm sorry. I'll share the screen as soon as you want me to.
Thank you. Jordy, are you with us?
Jordy is an interpreter, so he is interpreting. He's one of our two Spanish interpreters.
Fantastic. And Judy, how are you this morning?
Also an interpreter.
Oh, okay.
But she might be on the other channel doing the interpretation. Hi, Judy.
Okay.
Hi, Bethany. This is Natasha. I don't know if you can hear me, and I apologize if there's an echo.
Hey, Natasha. Do you want to introduce yourself?
I am with Greater Rancheria, but for this call, I'm just a community member. And I do recognize a photo on here, so I'm going to kick it over, and hopefully she's there, to Thalia. Maybe she's not.
Thalia wrote in the chat, "My name is Thalia, and I'm an MPH intern. I am just listening in for the event, currently at work. Thank you for your time and for hosting this wonderful event." Hi, Thalia, welcome. Sam?
I think he's away from his computer. Also, I am gonna move.
Okay. And Yvette. Hi, Yvette.
Hi, Yvette.
And Adriana. Are you there, Adriana?
Hey, everyone. I'm Adriana. I work for the health department, but for the purpose of this meeting, I'm only here as a committee member.
Okay, good to hear your voice, Adriana.
Yeah, good to see you too, Bethany.
Hi. And Aliyah, are you going to be participating with us today?
I am bouncing around, but hello, everybody. So nice to see you all.
Hey, does everyone have their jam boards? Like, is this working, Aliyah? How are the other rooms?
The other groups are, they have their jam boards going. Also, once you guys get started with that, feel free to share your screen so everybody can see the jam boards.
Okay. And Natasha, Otis, are you going to be participating with us today?
Oh, yeah. Hi, Bethany. I'm here at DHS and logistical support.
You're the awesome awesomeness with DHS that I always try to get to regional parks. hi, good to see you, or good to hear your voice this morning. All right, so we have a few of us that are available to start in on the project. So I think I can try sharing my screen once I pull this up. See if this works for me. Otherwise, I might call on my friends for support. Do you all see it?
Good job.
Okay, excellent. So in our group, we're to look at the questions below and then also the exercise that we just went through about the cultural wealth model and create an image here that really articulates across the county our cultural wealth. So should we just take one question at a time? And are you all able to pull up on your screens as well the pad here so people can contribute?
Bethany, I'm not able to pull on the pad because if I go into the link, it kicks me off of the Zoom meeting. So I'm
got it.
Happy to participate though, yeah.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, Adriana. I think that was Adriana by your voice.
It was.
Okay. Let me see if I can. So the first question that we have here, and Natasha, I know you're more of a tech whiz than I am. Are you able to record some of the things? Because on mine, I'm not really able to record right now.
Yeah, I think I can on the, let's see. Looks like page 2, your community map, or page 3. I can definitely get over to the Jamboard.
Here we go, I see. Oh, you're awesome. Okay, great. Oh, yay, I see it now. That's wonderful. Okay, so if you were able to record on page 3, that would be awesome. Thanks, got Natasha. It. And then, so the first question is, what cultural wealth or wealths are present in our community, thinking about the county as a whole, keeping in mind our most vulnerable and marginalized neighborhoods. So please. So I, you know. please
so
help
examples
me.
Of things like language, you know, or what, yeah, I mean, different languages, diversity.
Yeah, just to add, yes, the linguistic wealth is huge. The language is huge. And in terms of diversity, if you can go a little bit deeper, like what about diversity? Do different groups, what are they contributing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like I would, Sonoma County, I know we have a high population of Latinx people, right? You know, that's a huge piece of our diversity. So what do our Latinx people contribute to Sonoma County? What are the cultural wealths in addition to linguistic, right? In addition to language?
Yeah, food.
I'm also thinking about like working a lot of our communities in that are a part of marginalized groups that are in neighborhoods. I'm thinking about relational culture is really super strong, and that people tend to know neighbors and the families and also relational, working from relational culture, it creates more resilience and community connectedness is like the number one form of resilience of a community.
Yeah, Bethany, that's, you just named social wealth, right? So you called it relational, which I think is even a better word than social, but that's the social wealth that, that these folks have, right? So that's definitely a huge piece of what they bring.
Yeah. And then Natasha, thank you for capturing that, Natasha. And then I think Adriana was saying to be recorded on our map, linguistic wealth across the county. And Adriana, did you want to expand on that?
Okay. Sorry, I think I was muted. There's an echo, and maybe that's the reason I got muted. So I apologize about that. I'm not sure where the echo is coming from. I'm only using my phone. What did I mean by linguistic wealth? Is that what you're asking, Bethany?
No, or if you wanted to be more specific or expand on that, like in the context of the questions about just what are marginalized neighborhoods across the county, different thinking about cultural wealth. Is there anything else that you'd like to say about?
I don't know how large, but when I mean linguistic wealth, I don't only mean, of course, English and Spanish, but we have so many indigenous communities with so many different languages. I mean, I don't know, dozens of different languages that are spoken just here alone in this community that often, yeah, I was thinking really about them, about how they continue to foster their languages. They continue to teach their children, even though it's not a dominant language. They continue to use their language with their families, to still instill this with their children. So that's what I meant. I mean, I can give you examples of what different languages, but that's kind of what I was thinking.
Nice. Thank you, Adriana.
Okay.
Does anybody else have anything that they'd like to share? I know many of you all are serving in other capacities in this group. Other types of cultural wealth?
Can I just add?
Oh, sorry. I was gonna say, I wanted to add, I don't know if this would be really, I could add it to cultural wealth, but volunteerism. I know a lot of people who are, you know, have jobs, who are working, who are very involved in the community, and they still, you know, I've been meeting a lot of people who still, you know, cultivate and take time to help others in what ways, either by engaging in advocacy or just, I don't know, volunteerism would be something that's considered cultural wealth, but I think it's very strong in this community. There's a lot of people that are always willing to jump in and figure out where help is needed and to help.
I think I can piggyback off of that one a little bit and go into hospitality. You know, Sonoma County being huge on hospitality and viticulture being another one. So that's part of the arts and the growth that we see in our community. And that's coming together of different nationalities and tying things in with the language and celebration. In that, so hospitality is a big one in our area, I feel like, but bringing diverse groups and backgrounds together at different times throughout the year, throughout the region.
Carlos, you were going to mention something?
Yeah. These are all really great. And to go back to the indigenous languages, I just want to emphasize how important that is in being able to name that, because once we name that, and if we're committed to equity and using a culture wealth, we're like, we need to reach out. We need to make sure that we're working side by side, learning from these various indigenous people and organizations that they may have, not as a charity thing, but as like, you all have something that we need to learn from, right? And so by saying that, by mapping that, we're like, oh, that's a commitment. We need to make sure that whatever we're doing is working in solidarity with these indigenous peoples, and make sure that, you know, equity is meeting their needs, right, as such. So I just want to say thank you for naming that that demographic.
Thank you. And I was thinking one other thing about the navigational wealth piece. And I know that the when we were speaking about it, it was more about within systems, but I'm also gonna refer to it as physical navigation, because our county, or the geographic spread of our county, is so far reaching. And so most marginalized populations are in pocketed geographic areas that tend to be a little bit more isolated. And so thinking about it from the lens of navigational wealth and having folks overcome the geographic barriers in order to create connections and get the resources that folks need is definitely a aspect of the cultural wealth, but it's also feeds into the secondary question that was on our list about inequities. So does anybody have anything else that they would like to share as far as the first question goes? What cultural wealths are present in our community from like a countywide perspective, keeping in mind our most vulnerable and marginalized neighbors?
Maybe I can add, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I was gonna say, I really wanna give a shout out to the powerful female presence in this county, women. I didn't grow up in this county, so coming to this county, it was very interesting to kind of immerse myself into the power of women and how they build community and how they have this voice, strong voice and presence in this county, and how Latinas or Latinx are actually starting to kind of come through that too, brown women and join into that force and having a strong voice. But I definitely started to get my education in feminism in this county, and I'm very grateful for that. So I really think that there is a very strong, a female power here that I think it's very important.
I would love to know some examples there that I can put on that note beyond, but that's inspiring. If you have any more, I can add to it. Like an example of when like mujeres, women have like been in a leadership role or have led an effort, a community effort, for change.
Do you want an example? Are you?
Yeah, that would be great. Exactly. Yes.
So I mean, I mean, I was going to say we have Bethany right here too. She's been a great, you know, inspiration and leader too. Alegría is one great example. We have, you know, how she really drove it home with the whole Office of Equity, right? When we were just in the talks, and she really pushed and pushed and pushed until we, you know, the county created a department, for example, right? And it wasn't just her alone. Also, even during the 2017 fires, I remember how a group of us really pushed internally for language access. And, you know, I'm sure it was led by more than females, but a very strong core group of Latinx female leaders within, inside, serving as translators, as public information officers, right? And it was really just supporting each other. We were, I remember, you know, just fighting to make sure that people could have access to communications to really save their lives, right? And not giving up. So this is, of course, an effort of a lot of different Latina leaders, including some that are in this meeting. I'm trying to think what other efforts. Luz Navarrete, she's a professor. I think she retired already, but I'm thinking about her as well. I'm thinking about how she brings, you know, culture. She's brought a lot of the perspective of culture and honoring your ancestors through the educational system with, you know, she has a very strong presence in this county. Thinking about, gosh, there's so many. What other efforts?
Adriana, that's awesome. I mean, the reason I asked for examples is because I'm taking notes for us. But those are great. Yeah, so if you have more, keep it up. But I just wanted to let you know that it wasn't a quiz. I'm actually getting stuff down for you.
Sure. Yeah. No, I'm sure I have a lot of them. I think my mind is filled with them, that there's like a jam in thought process right now. There's a lot of stuff. I'm actually just thinking about, in the same context, a group of really just grassroots leaders in our community when the pandemic broke. I'm thinking about Dr. Ramirez, Tony Ramirez, and Ana Lugo, and Mara Ventura, like how they were relentless at spearheading to make sure that everyone had access. Everyone had access to testing, for example, to really start to look at the people who didn't have access to medical care or to support. And due to that effort, the Latinx Health Group was formed, as an example, that's still, I believe, still operational within the Department of Health. That's another example. So we definitely have a lot of very passionate people and passionate women. I think we are known in this county for that. So it's really, yeah, it's a very wealthy county when it comes to that. And I'm trying to illustrate the positive, because I can definitely like illustrate what have been a lot of the barriers to get there, but I don't think that's what the conversation is about, but yeah.
Inspiring.
Thank you, Adriana. And Natasha, I saw that you unmuted yourself. Natasha Otis, did you want to share anything?
Oh, I'm sorry, someone was delivering boxes, and so I had to step away, but I was listening.
Oh, the other Natasha.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. Natasha Medell, thank you so much for taking notes.
Actually, I can't take credit. Curtis is doing the notes.
Oh, thank you, Curtis.
I started on page three, and then Curtis jumped to page two, so he's got it.
Thank you.
Trying to break the gender norms.
Thank you. All right. So just unless folks have anything else to share, maybe we can jump back to the second question, which is identifying inequities that exist in our community. And let's look at the third. Well, let's start with that as well. Identify inequities that exist within our community. Well, one of the things that always sparks my attention, and I appreciate Curtis and Carlos kind of paying closer attention to this than I've seen in the past, but a lot of our debts that we owe the community, we often focus solely on the Latinx community from a countywide perspective and the data that we share, and also how we speak about the debts that we owe the community and the disparities and equities in our community. So one of the things that I'd like to just bring to the forefront on the Sonoma County map is the other groups that are often marginalized that aren't necessarily raised to the forefront of our conversation, like Indigenous communities. We have a really strong network of 8 tribes and tribal bands in Sonoma County. And we're not always seeing data and the conversation revolving around our Indigenous communities. And then also the Black community in particular. And we have a strong Eritrean community that lives particularly in Santa Rosa, but also just Black community in general that isn't necessarily highlighted in how the county is sharing story about and being inclusive of how we're, as a part of our narrative, I guess I should say, how we're addressing the inequities in order to move towards justice. So I just wanted to highlight that as an opportunity and an inequity. Anything else that comes to folks in mind?
I think I'd like to add that you're right, Bethany, representation is definitely missing. And I think something even more fundamental than representation is giving people voice and equal power with their voice. Like, you know, some voices sometimes wait more or are stronger and louder than others. And I think that's a hard one, because I often do see that not everybody's voice is giving that, I don't know, equal opportunity or the same weight as other voices. Oftentimes even, you know, even myself, I could tell you that I have to be very mindful if I am trying to bring up a topic, an issue of, let's say, an Indigenous community member, I'm still representing the oppressing culture in their eyes. You know, I'm, you know, Chicana, but I'm still, you know, part, you know, you think about it, right? So how do we not... what's the word? It's evading my mind right now, but that we're not giving them voice through our own experience, and how do we give them a platform for them to have their own voice? And that is a huge inequity, I think. And I can say it like it staggers. It's this hierarchy. Like even in myself, in my experience with the county, has been that my voice hasn't had much value and strength until somebody who doesn't look like me with more power can actually share my ideas or give me that power and strength. So that's the reason why I'm thinking about other, I have such great privilege that I'm thinking about other communities that don't, and how do I foster that without actually taking over and like acculturating or appropriating their culture, if that makes any sense.
I totally agree, Adriana, and I was thinking about hierarchy and how much value we place on people's titles and their positions, and
certainly within the county structure, but all over. And in a group that I'm in, we just had someone apply to be in the group, but they are like lower level staff in their organization. And so someone in our group was like, well, we're looking for decision makers and C-suite level people to be in this group. And I just thought that's a shame that that's, we're still there, that it depends on what title you hold for your opinion to be valued. And I know that part of that is if you're making a decision on behalf of your organization, you want the decision makers in the room. And I totally get that, but it just leaves us where we are, and it doesn't allow for the voices that we need to be heard. So
thank you, Leah.
Yeah.
Does anybody else have anything that they would like to share about the inequities in our community? They're deep.
Yeah.
There's so many. Where do we begin? But I really got, thinking about what you just said about, actually, this got triggered to me early on in the beginning of this initial conversation right here, when we're talking about the lands that we are on in our indigenous population community, right? And I know that that has always been a struggle. Like at one point in some of the work that I was doing and engaging with our indigenous folks that originally inhabited these lands who are still, you know, in reservations. And I know because I have family that are like part of, they're from the FOMO community. And then just in talking to them, how we are, even our engagement is in a sense inequitable, if it sounds like that. I know that, you know, you mentioned, Bethany, how we've been seeing a lot of things through the Latinx lens, which I could see that, and I can see how we need to amplify that to engage with a lot of other groups and communities. And and I'm not sure if, you know, I know we're thinking about it. I'm not sure if we're there yet to actually intentionally and authentically engage with these communities and to really think that it's on their terms. It takes time, and it's not, oftentimes working through the county is like, we are guided by set rules, strategic process and plans, and we have to follow a certain way of doing things. But oftentimes, this is not how these communities will engage with us, and how, so it's hard. It's hard for people in our positions to do that when we are engaging, when we're coming as I'm a county worker, if that makes any sense, right? So, because that in a sense is already a barrier oftentimes. Until we build trust, right? And we're away from that.
And I think that's a wonderful segue. Thank you, Adriana, to the next component, and actually, in my opinion, the most important component of this question is, how does our map align with the concept of in the Kesh? You know, because it's one of the thoughts that I had was based on what you just said, Adriana. You just mentioned the last sentence about building trust and building relationship, you know. And for me, and Lakesh, and like a simplified, very simplified version is creating a sense of connectedness and belonging and oneness, and through love and heart connection. You know, so what do you all think? how does our map align with the concept of in Lakesh? You already started us, Adriana, thank you. Natasha, do you have any thoughts about that? And just because I know at the beginning of the our time together when we went over in Lakesh, I'm just to remind everybody just some of the concepts of it. And I took a photo because I love it so much. I've been to four of your all's workshops. So. but in Lakesh's, the philosophy is you are my other me. If I do harm to you, I do harm to myself. If I love and respect you, I love and respect myself. And I apologize, I omitted the Spanish piece of that.
I don't know how our map aligns, but I do feel like I love it too. And if we all could be more open and loving, but that is the respecting of other people's culture and being willing to just be curious and learn about it and not just, you know, I'm kind to you or I give you, you know, but extending yourself to really understand where someone else is coming from and taking it a step further from than niceties and friendliness, but that it's how do you come into this work or this meeting or this thing we're doing together? And my expectations of you might be really grounded or seated in my own reality and not in where you're coming from. And you know who taught me so much about that? Adriana, about like my expectations when working with people and that I brought like a really judgmental and narrow frame of how to, I don't know, enact in the workplace, and that it was like completely based on my own background and privilege and to like, it's not just about like, I want to treat you the way I want to be treated. It's I want to treat you the way you deserve to be treated and with understanding of where you're coming from. And that it's not just assimilate to my way of doing things, but let me way better understand your background. And yeah. I have carried that with me, friend, for, yeah, I love you.
You're gonna make me cry, see? I miss you so much.
I miss you too. I like our little breakout group. I'm so glad I get to see your face.
I know, me too. Great. I'm like, this is the second time I'm crying. I was crying in one of the videos too. I'm like, oh geez. But yeah, thank you. Thank you, Leah. And I know you're honest and genuine, and that's why I love you so much, because you're authentic. And yeah, so you're awesome.
I just think we have to do more. We have to do more than just acknowledge. We have to like work. It's a little bit of work.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know, was it you or was it, maybe it was, I think it was you that mentioned, you know, this niceness. And it's sometimes, you know, we have to, and I know I had a hard time because I've always played the nice card to be able to survive and fit in and, you know, not get kicked off out of the island early on. So I lasted this long because of that. But it's like, I think it's, yeah, it's not about being nice. It's about being real and about mm-hmm. having those really hard heart-to-heart conversations, right? And I am, like, so overdue and so ready. So thank you. Yeah, you have been one of those catalysts in my development. So I really appreciate it, Leah. And so many of you have, so yeah.
It's been a real honor to be in this space and to hear all this. And I think if I may just like synthesize a lot of like your brilliance because it's there. Like, I think there's a lot of potential by building off of the pink column to answer, start answering that the green note over on this on the right side, which Adriana brought up about the authenticity of and really the self-determination of Indigenous peoples, and their it's on their time. That's that wisdom, Adriana, is like is deep, deep. But if you look at the pink column, I think you see right, with the feminism and the women leadership and the spirit in the room right now, you see like a model of how to live in Enlakesh, how to have Enlakesh drive equity to change. And so I wonder if like you all could think or like go back to that lens as next steps and think about what that looks like and being in relation with Indigenous people and other groups that I think a lot of times are refugee communities are very similar in, it's not the same at all, but similar in it's on their own time. And there's ways we can like, but I think there's like, with our refugee communities, I think, unfortunately, we're fighting against like the, it's a false gift that's given to them in this country, right? Of, you know, of these institutions, like come this way, you know, rather like, I think we can learn from the way we work with the way we were trying to work in relationship with Indigenous and Native folks, that there's a maybe a better way out there so that we don't offer them the assimilation drug and all those other things that's going to cost them, you know, time. Like a lot of times I feel like in America culture, it's about like getting there faster. But if you I think there's a bill to pay for that, a bill to pay with your soul. And I think that lacks authenticity and you get plugged in and you can almost be used. You lose generational contact with your children. And that's not the ways I've been learning from Indigenous folks, nor my own cultura. Anyway, so, but I think there's just a lot of wealth in that pink column that could be used as a frame moving forward. Go figure, women, authentic women leaders that are grounded leading us, that'd be kind of beautiful. I'm gonna mute myself.
Before we get kicked off, I just wanna say Bethany, Adriana, to my sisters, Leah, thank you guys so much. I unfortunately had interruptions going on, so I was here and out, but thank you for carrying this dialogue and facilitating this. So thank you to you sisters.
It's so nice to meet you, Natasha. Hi.
It's so funny because we've all worked together before, and then you all know each other. We know each other through each other. Yeah. Natasha, did you have? I saw you unmuted yourself before Curtis was speaking too. Did you have anything else you wanted to share?
I was just, you know, the thing that stood out for me was language, right? You know, in terms of aligning the map is language is a big one, right? So, and just learning each other's language and how that looks and how we want to be communicated with, you know, whether it's traditional language or, you know, love language, you know, whatever that looks like is being open to learning, you know, languages so we can start having that communication dialogue to moving and growing together forward. So that's the one that popped out, and that's kind of where we started, I feel like, was going around language.
Thank you.
Who's reporting out for us?
And wait, and Talia, I know you've been like working and here by, you know, listening in, but if you wanted to say anything in the chat about the conversation, you're welcome to contribute to so we capture your voice. Okay.
I'm gonna, Aaliyah's asking if she can, she should bring us back, and I'm saying yes.
And Adriana, do you want to report out for us? I don't want to put you on the spot, but you had a really strong, you know, voice throughout this. No worries if not.
I feel safe right here. I don't know if I'll feel safe reporting out to the entire group. I could do my best. I'll need to read the notes, I'll be honest. What I said right now was just heartfelt, but I don't really remember.
Do you want me to, well, if I can back you up.
You can back me up?
I'll be like this. I'll be like,
I'm here to back you up too, Adriana. Bethany, so I'll back you up while you back her up, and then we'll, yeah. We got you.
Okay, I mean, if I can read the board, I'll try to log in through a different computer just so I can remember. So what was it
that Adriana, what's your, I'll take a picture of it.
Oh, and, yeah, if you can
and
do that,
send it to you. What's your tech, or what's your, where do you want me to send it?
Yeah, to my phone, and I can pull it in my computer. So 707-889.
Wait, I just want to let you know that this is being recorded.
Okay, send it to her in the chat. We'll we're all back.
That's okay. My phone number is pretty much public, so it's okay.
I just wanted to remind you that it was being recorded.
Leah, will you forward me her contact because you have my cell number?
Yes.
Okay.
And then Curtis and Carlos, take it away. Sorry for the.
Well, everyone's back. I didn't know because Beth has still seen Bethany's screen. Hey, everybody. so we have 20 minutes left. If you could go ahead and put your like facilitator / sharer names, the folks that are sharing in the chat, so we can just call on y'all and we'll see how far we can get in the next 20 minutes and whether or not you can, you know, as far as like how many folks can share. And speaking of sharing, we do have screen sharing capabilities for everybody now, right? Correct, tech folks? Yeah, I'm just gonna assume so. So yeah, oh, it looks like it. Oh, that it's Sandy's is volunteering. So sorry, I don't have my chat up here. Yeah, so it's for the groups, each group, if you, can you name your town / city and or region like in your group, and then let us know who is the facilitator, and then we'll go around popcorn style. Or yeah. Carlos, does that sound okay? Okay, he says that sounds okay. You were supposed to, Yvette, you were supposed to figure that out in your room. Shaming. All right, cool. Sonoma's got Dora and Javi. If you don't mind starting, y'all, that let's just go in order. Dora and Javi, and then Northern Sonoma County, Windsor, Healdsburg, is Geyserville, Cloverdale. I want to make sure I get everybody representation. Jenny Chamberlain and Holly Fox. So we'll go. So Dora and Javi, if you want to start, and then Jenny and Holly. And if you want to share, yeah, I was just gonna say, if you want to share your screen, please do. No shame if you don't want to share the screen either. Like if you just want to articulate in from your hearts. Okay. Yeah.
I don't see Javi, so I don't know if he unmuted himself. But can you all hear me? Okay. We didn't finish. We actually had a lot of conversation because we did Sonoma Valley in specific, which is a smaller city town here in Sonoma County. I am born and raised. Javi moved 2 years ago, and then we also had one person who's actually in a different state, but our Office of Equity intern. So we started off with first describing what Sonoma is to us. So there's this town called Sonoma, and then there's the unincorporated area, which I grew up in, which is the Springs, El Verano, Agua Caliente, Boys Hot Spring, and how it's always been divided. So pretty much from Taco Bell to Agua Caliente, that's where our community is and lives. And and thrives. But let me start with at least some of the pictures that we decided to add up here.
Did you want me to share? Do we get sharing capabilities?
So I'm sharing our pictures right now.
Perfecto.
So linguistic wealth, we put our schools because there's schools in our community, El Verano School and Flowery School, who have been really championing making our education bilingual. So there's schools that incorporate learning Spanish and about involving the community around them. So I'm really proud of, I'm an El Verano student and I'm really proud of what they've done. And then we also have La Luz down here as social wealth, because it's a community resource where anything happens, if somebody has an issue, I don't know, with their landlord, or they need translation services, or they need to get unemployment, or they can't navigate a website, they will go to La Luz and they will be helped. And La Luz has done a great job of actually hiring community members to represent and to teach the community members of what they're learning. I actually participated in the leadership program that they did not too long ago and learned a lot and knocked on doors for the census. Javi, I don't know if there's any other ones you want to take over.
Yeah, and so there was a couple parts in which we were trying to really hone in on the ancestral wealth, particularly around migration and immigration when we're talking about land in which we're at and not sometimes not even really knowing so much about where maybe some of where our own families come from in the depths and the roots of where we come from, but that there's a reality that potentially even these lands, you know, families and generations and ancestors before us have already been here. So sometimes it could be a coming back too. But even with that, there's a lot that we bring when there's migration and folks coming and settling here at times. You know, what we talked about and Dora had mentioned is the knowledge and culture that comes back and forth, because sometimes folks do come back and forth, but then other times it's really, there's not a possibility of going back. And so really settling and building those roots here. And then we see that as a collective in some of these other images. So that's kind of the part that image depicts with a migration of folks. I don't know if we have time to share all of them, but I want to give other people time. So I don't want to go like
all over. I'll summarize the last two really quick. So we have navigational wealth here. If you see that top, I'm not even pointing, I'm pointing with my mouse and you guys can't see it. but top right corner, that's the plaza. That's something that you don't see a lot of our community on that side of town. But
thanks to that. We can't see your screen. I think we're looking at another slide. Unless everybody else can and I can't.
No, we're looking at the
No, we're looking at the first slide.
Yeah.
Well, so I'm not sharing the.
You might need to stop share and then get to the slide you want to do and then reshare again.
Did that work?
Yes.
Beautiful.
Top right corner, that's the plaza, and an area that's not created for us. That's just tourists, wealthy tourists. All the surrounding restaurants are crazy expensive, and stores. I've never once walked into one of the stores there. But thanks to organizations, once a year, there's a giant festival where all our community gathers there. So I see that as navigational wealth. And then top, the paletero man and elotero men that we have in our community that we all have known forever, because they've been selling in this area forever. That's aspirational wealth to us. And the barrier can sometimes be the sheriff's office, because We have seen in our community them being pulled over and not being allowed to sell in certain areas, I see it as harassment, but that's aspirational wealth and for our community. So definitely want other people to share. So I'm just gonna cut it short there. Sorry you weren't seeing it in the beginning.
No, gracias, Dora y Javier is awesome. Awesome. So thank you. Thanks for kicking us off and being brave to start us. And your youthful voices filled me up too. So Northern Sonoma County is going to be Holly and Jenny. Take it away.
Holly, if you can share the screen.
Yeah,
Holly and I are going to co-do this. But what we really emphasized throughout our conversation was the familiar wealth? What was it, that one? The ancestral wealth. I'm sorry. The ancestral wealth. Because North County just has so much of it. And I think at the end of our conversation, it was really pointed out that a lot of our North County historical societies, they don't share the story of our Native American tribes or even with our Chicano history that we have in North County. It's the white Anglo version. So what a lot of people don't know, Sonoma County has a total of 8 Pomo tribes. We didn't discuss this part. 3 of those reside in my district in Northern Sonoma County. So there's growing up in Northern Sonoma County, in elementary, we were taught a lot of our Native traditions. We took field trips to the reservations, and it was a huge part of our history that was taught to us. I grew up in North County in the 70s and 80s, graduated and with that, what a lot of people don't know is that a lot of the original Chicano or Latino families in North County are from Texas, like my family. So there's this big migration that happened in the 50s. A lot of the families who picked cotton in the South migrated from Texas to Windsor, Hillsburg, Cloverdale. A lot of them first did the trek to Central Valley. And like my family in particular, the working conditions were harder and the heat was harder. So a lot of people moved to Sonoma County because that was the land of hopes and dreams as my family were taught it. And so you have generational families that migrated here. And then you have a lot of like Latino families who've been there. We forget that California used to be Mexico, right? A lot of the Mexican families and the Native American families, we all intermingle. A lot of my cousins are half Pomo and half Mexican. So that's part of the history that wasn't discussed. And another part of the history that we discuss is a lot of people don't know about Windsor. A lot of the original neighborhoods in Windsor, especially on the west side where I grew up, a lot of those homes are from government grants. And it just didn't include the Mexican American families. If you think about John Steinbeck's The Grapes of Wrath, there's this big migration since like the Dust Bowl of families coming from the South, Alabama and whatnot. So you had Windsor was actually originated, in my opinion, as a farm worker town. And a lot of people made fun of us back in the day. They used to tell us, oh, you got a Windsor education or you Windsor and no one shows up, because that was before Windsor was incorporated. But we stood through, right? And the government gave the low-income families grants to build their own houses. There wasn't no fancy developer that came and said, I'm going to build a neighborhood. And one reason why that story is particular soft to my heart is because my grandfather helped build a lot of those houses. And that's a part of our North County history that not too many people know about. But I'm going to hand it off to Holly because she's going to help. I can go all over the board. So Holly, I recruited Holly to keep me on track. So Holly,
I love Sonoma County history, so I love hearing these stories. But yeah, we had a long and wide ranging conversation, but we really identified areas of, you know, we have that sort of that paper chain of people across the top. And I think what we were talking about is the ways that our sort of informal networks, our family community, those strong bonds are sometimes an invisible but a really important familial wealth, can also be used, can turn into a resistant wealth when it's activated. We have some photos from some of the protests last year in Healdsburg when a council member said that we didn't have an issue essentially said that we didn't have an issue with racism in our community. We want to show those deep roots, some of what Jenny was talking about, but then show sort of where that's gone and what that's turning into. We have the photo of the first gen grad to represent our aspirational wealth. And we also have, we've got a vaccine clinic flyer and also this photo of a little boy hugging a firefighter after, I'm actually getting emotional, returning after the evacuation for the Kincaid fire. And we talked a lot about the ways that our community has come together during crisis, during the fires, during COVID, and again, sort of built out those networks and worked together to create a stronger community despite or because of those challenges. So yeah, this is what we put together.
And we also talk about embracing each other's cultural, right? Cultures. Yep. I mean, for me as a Latina, that there's, we're always, my community understand us, learn my culture. But for me, speaking as a Latina, what am I doing to understand other people's cultures, embracing it? And whether you're Irish or Dutch or Japanese, or we had one of our members who was married to a gentleman who's Palestinian, and she shared how hard it was for her, her family to share both cultures, because if they could put up one flag in their front yard, but the Palestinian flag, what type of response would they get? And that culture, especially for her children, should be equally celebrated, right? So how are we understanding? How are we listening without judgment? Instead of asking the question, why, for me, I like my tortillas, right? But someone who from India, you know, who uses naan instead of tortillas, instead of me asking, why are you using naan for? I should say, can you share your food with me? Can you tell me about this? I want to embrace and love your cold food or whatever, your dance or whatever. And how do we do that? And once we start doing that as a people, then I think we can spread the love. And that's where one of the foundations of where it begins.
Thank you both very much. I'm looking at the time and knowing that we're not going to have an opportunity to hear the brilliance of all the groups, but I'm just really happy that you all were able to engage with this. Carlos, any thoughts before we throw it back to Leah?
I'm just super inspired. I was room jumping everywhere, and I was like, this is hella on point. Some of you got artistic, some of you were just providing so much great tech. So thank you so much, y'all, for getting through all the, maybe it wasn't a barrier for you as far as technology, but you all, if we can jump right in and just, you're all experts of your community and you're all committed to a transformation equity. And so it's just wonderful to witness that.
And part of the not apologizing after I apologized is that we don't mind leaving you in a mess. Halfway done with something, because it inspires you to finish it off together. So part of the reason we created these jam boards, we didn't know you were going to be so amazing with them. Of course, we hoped, but we were so that you can continue to share, so that these things can evolve. And this isn't the last Health Action meeting. And so these jam boards don't need to go anywhere except for up, meaning where you want to go next, and where things need to improve locally and in the smaller municipalities, but also in the countywide. And we're really honored and humbled, as always, to be a part of that with you. We look forward, we're actually gonna be visiting this weekend. Carlos and I are gonna be in the North County this weekend with our neighbors, and with your neighbors in Healdsburg. Okay, so again, much love, and back to you, Leah. I look forward to more times face-to-face in the future. Be safe, everyone.
Thank you. We are all clapping. We love you so much. That was an incredible morning. My goodness. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, both of you, so much. And to all of you for participating, for sharing. Yes, we will send you the video, the slides, each other's jam boards, all of it, and a survey that I hope Michael Tinoco drops in our chat right now, just so we can get feedback. And you can tell Curtis and Carlos how much you love them too. And you can reach out to them. They are wonderful. And as far as what's next for Health Action, we're certainly not done with this conversation and this change and growth that we're all continuously experiencing. And we hope you bring the community cultural wealth model to your groups and communities. I think you can see how to walk people through it. It's wonderful. And also we have the Health Action chapters that we'd love you to get more involved in and to join and to bring these conversations locally to your own cities and communities. So a little bit of that will be in the survey as well. Our next Health Action Council meeting is in August. So let's communicate in between. And I just really, really appreciate you all being here today, staying with the whole thing, doing the breakout groups, being open. Just have a wonderful rest of your day and weekend. And I just feel really good. Thank you so much, Curtis and Carlos. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Great job.
Much love.
Curtis and Carlos, you constantly inspire me, and I am super stoked on you all. I know I said, but I hella love you guys so much.
We love you too. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you for being here. You're awesome.
Every time, all the time, invite me, invite me, invite me. I'll be there.
Oh, I love your double glasses. Oh my God.
One is the blue blockers. I don't get the headaches, and the other one is because now I'm 40 something and I can't read anymore.
They look great together. I think we're going to start kicking people off so that we can chat with each other. So if I remove you, don't be offended.
Can I stay? Unless you want to say something. To just make sure that I'm connecting through Office of Equity stuff. Okay. Yay.